this commitment crumbles. I can't believe that I'm here again. My life be like time like me, don't make me say. Lord, if you see me, please come my way. Like leaving breadcrumbs for the night. Welcome back. Welcome back to the Clark Athletic Center. I'm now joined by Steve Witowski. Steve, how's it going this afternoon?
Good. I mean, it's a lot better weather than a couple Saturdays ago when we were here. Very snowy. Now it's great weather. Great to see you, Alex, and it should be a fun one.
Great to see you too, Steve. Excited to get this one underway. A couple good games today on our doubleheader, and looking at this one, like I talked about in the intro, I'm excited because this game, I get a feeling, is going to take all 40 minutes.
Yeah, I mean, the history of these two teams playing against each other, it's very competitive. Obviously, big conference game for both teams today. Both kind of in the middle of the pack. UMass Boston at number 4 and Keene State, obviously, at number 3. Very exciting game, and it should be a very competitive game, to say the least.
So, Steve, you mentioned the last time we were together is that blizzard back at the beginning of January when the Beacons took on the Anchor Women of Rhode Island College. We throw to those highlights now. I'm being told we don't have the highlights, so it's live broadcasting, folks. It happens, and we move on. So, Steve, as we take a look at what these teams do well, what these teams don't do well, the three-point numbers really stand out to me.
Yeah, I mean, both teams, obviously, at the top of the conference in three-point shooting, and actually they're both at the top of the conference in three-point defending, so it should be a clash of talents here tonight.
Another thing, as I look at it now, the rebounding margin for UMass Boston is a dead zero. That's going into the decimals. A dead zero. This is a team that they rebound well, but they give up a lot of rebounds too. There's going to be a lot available on the glass in this one. How important is it for them to come out of here winning the rebound margin?
Yeah, I mean, you mentioned it, player of the game, Raven Kelsey. Very aggressive down low. You got to look to her to kind of grab those rebounds that are kind of floating up in the air, and she's got to make adjustments to really be a significant factor in tonight's game.
She is the team's leading rebounder as we take a look at the team leaders for each squad. And Stephanie Donolfo, you don't see her, or you see her there quite a, I don't see her there, but she is top three in pretty much every major category, third in points, second in rebounds. She leads the team in assists, steals, and blocks. It's gonna be about shutting her down today.
Yeah, I mean, and you see Grace Geary on the team leaders for UMass Boston. She has not played last game. Not expected to play this game, so someone's got to really step up, especially shooting-wise. Last game, they didn't shoot so hot, only 30% from field goal percentage and 55% from the free throw line.
Keep an eye on Sandy Purcell as well, number 3 in red, the leading scorer for the Owls. Both Purcell and Lydia Vital, number 20 in red, are top 7 in the conference in scoring, averaging 13.6 and 12.3 points per game, respectively. If Grace Geary doesn't play, UMass Boston's leading scorer is Raven Kelsey, just a tick under 12 points a game. Taking a look at who's at the bench, you have kind of experience versus the up-and-comer in this one. At the helm of the visiting Keene State Owls is head coach Keith Boucher in his 28th year, a graduate of the University of New Hampshire, just won his 400th game a couple weeks ago, a career record of 404 and 327. On the other side, Christina Baugh in her second season, her first full season with the Beacons. She has a career record of 22-22, a Providence College graduate, spent her last three seasons as an assistant at Central Connecticut State.
Yeah, I mean, obviously her first full season, exciting to see what they're going to do later in this year. 4-4 right now in the conference, scuffling a little bit coming into this game, obviously, with a loss against the UMass Dartmouth, which was a very good game, but they did have a little bit of a win streak against Southern Maine and Western Connecticut State, so we'll see if they can bring that into tonight's matchup.
Mentioned last time out for the Beacons, a loss against 15-3 UMass Dartmouth. Up towards the top of the conference are the Crosshairs. Raven Kelsey in that one had 14 points, also 3 steals. Taje Burston coming off a great all-around game, 13 points, 4 assists, 4 steals in that one.
Kind of add on that game. Obviously, they took the loss against UMass Dartmouth, but they kind of dig themselves a little too big of a hole. We'll see tonight if they can kind of keep the game within reach. I know the last couple games have gone into OT and have been close at the end. So for the Beacons to kind of keep the game close is going to be huge tonight.
Speaking of close games, last time out, the Owls, a heartbreaking 63-62 loss at the hands of conference leader Eastern Connecticut. Denolfo in that one, 16 points and 10 rebounds, a double-double. Vital, 16 points as well. Okay, we're going to step aside real quick when we come back. Anthem, starting lineups, and basketball. Keep it here. You're getting ready to watch the UMass Boston Beacons and the Keene State Owls on the Beacon Broadcast Network.
What separates UMass Boston from other schools is the fact that a large percentage of students commute. For me, it takes 2 hours each day to go to and from school. But every second has been worth it because the students that come here are serious about learning, they value their education, and understand where it'll take them in the future. This is what UMass Boston means to me.
Back here at the Clark Athletic Center, now time to take a look at the starting lineups as we get ready for jump. First for the visiting Keene State Owls, Sandy Purcell again the leading scorer, the two guards, Lydia Vital, the two leading scorers for Keene State, and of course, Denolfo, the reigning conference defensive player of the year. You have to keep an eye on her as well. For the Beacons, minus the absence of Grace Geary, pretty much what we've come to expect from UMass Boston this year. Burston, like I mentioned, coming off the big game. And no start for Raven Kelsey in this one. She will come off the bench.
Yeah, it's going to be a very exciting game, obviously. Only six games left in the year for UMass Boston, so it's crunch time, and we'll see how they perform.
We're going to pause the national anthem, and then we'll be underway. All right, getting ready to tip here. Steve, keys to the game.
Yeah, I mean, when you look at the keys to the game, you have to look at Raven Kelsey, obviously, off the bench. Who wins the three-point battle? We talked about it before. Both very good at three-pointers. Libet Denolfo's production, obviously, one of the key players for Keene State. And you have to do a better job at the free throw line. I think that goes for the men's and women's teams at UMass Boston. They have to do a better job hitting crucial free throws.
On the UMass Boston, right in the middle of the conference, they are fifth. They shoot about 64% from the stripe. Keene State, 65% from the stripe. Now, here's a stat that I find interesting, and some people say this doesn't actually mean anything. Opponent's free throw percentage. And people say, oh, well, you can't defend it, so what does it matter? It is somewhat of an indication, I'd say it's a tell-all, of if you're making smart fouls, if you're fouling people who, you know, may not be as successful at the line. The Beacons have one of the lowest opponent free throw percentages in the league at 63%. Keene State's opponents are shooting 66. So you'd expect the Beacons to get some of their better free throw shooters to the line, and then even more reason to need to convert on those chances.
Yeah, I mean, that's a great point that you just made. But you also have to look at Grace Geary not being here, one of the better free throw shooters for the Beacons. It's going to be interesting to see who's going to take the scoring on and take the playmaker ability on.
Among players who, you know, play regularly, Grace Geary does lead the team in free throw percentage, just a bit shy of 80%. So they will miss her today. And we'll see how they make up for it. Also, like I mentioned, Raven Kelsey not in the starting lineup. She will come off the bench. Not top three in minutes, but I'd expect her to be over the 28 per game she averages today.
And you can see the energy is starting to rise on both sides. They know it's a crucial game in conference. It's coming to the end of the year. A huge game for both teams.
And if this is your first time watching women's college basketball in the last 2 years, a quarter format adopted by the NCAA last year. So we'll go four 10-minute frames opposed to the 220s they do in the men's game. And Steve, I'm actually a fan of that.
Yeah, I mean, it kind of shortens the, I mean, it elongates the game. It gives the coach a little more time to talk to their players. It definitely, you get to see which coach is really coaching better.
See, it lengthens the game, and I think that's true. In a way, it shortens the game as well because the timeouts change, and you don't get all these tedious timeouts that really just, to me, the worst part of basketball to me is the tedious timeouts at the end of halves and the end of games.
Yeah, I mean, you see it in college basketball nowadays all the time. 2 minutes in the last 2 minutes of the game can last 15 minutes real time.
Martiza Scott will jump for the Beacons. Amanda Petro jumps for Keene State, and we are underway. Petro wins it. The Owls are wearing red jerseys with white trim and white numbers. They move right to left across your screen. The Beacons in their home whites with the blue trim moving left to right. They get it out to Purcell. Owls leading scorer kicks it out. This is DeNolfo into the post, draws the double team, kicks it out. The three-pointer comes up short, just gets the netting, trying to keep it in, but stepping on the line was DeNolfo. The air ball coming from number 23, Kenzie Bennett.
And number 12, Maritza Scott is another player to watch, a very versatile freshman, very good defensively, and has her moments on offense.
They try to get in the post to Elia Bodie, tied up. It will go jump ball. Possession arrow shows Beacons. 30 seconds in, still no score. Burston will inbound underneath. Still trying to get it in, and she's going to get called for a 5 second. And you got to have that internal clock going in your head.
Yeah, I mean, and kind of touch on Grace Geary not being here. When she goes out there, the offense seems to flow a little bit better. One of the upperclassmen on this team, she very good point guard. So we'll see how the offense kind of flows early on in this game.
Purcell back to Bennett now, near side wing Vital. Far side wing DeNolfo, 7 on the shot clock, drives in, hop step, underhanded layup, doesn't even get the rim. Rebound comes to Elia Bodie. Here comes Burston the other way, a minute in. Hesitation move, drives, left side elbow, tried to kick it out, it's out of bounds off the Beacons. And that second turnover for Burston.
Yeah, and that's another thing that kind of plagued the Beacons so far this year, especially in their losses, is the amount of turnovers they really have. Very careless with the ball this far in the season.
That's two turnovers, still no score. Beacons turn it over more than any team in the conference. They also force more turnovers than any team in the conference. Bennett, back to Vital. Taken away by Burson. It's called a jump, maybe a little prematurely. It's going to stay with the Owls.
Yeah, you mentioned it. They do call a lot of, they do make a lot of turnovers for the Beacons. Last game we did together, Rhode Island College, a lot of turnovers in that game.
Up and under DeNolfo with the first points of the game, 8:23 remaining in the first quarter. Burston lobs a pass over to Katie Matthew. Matthew looking inside, gets it to the corner. Chantel Jordan, and we have a foul away from the ball. It's going to be another turnover on the Beacons.
And that's something the Beacons really have struggled. And that's where their offense has really struggled. Just so many turnovers, not getting off shots, really has hurt them offensively.
But still just 2 points for the Owls. DeNolfo to the wing. Purcell tries to get a shot up. It's tipped right into the hands of Petro. Petro in the post. Goes around. Ball goes around the rim and in. 4-0 Keene. .745 to go. They're playing Burston to move to her right. Almost looks like a 3-2 zone. And I think that's what it is. They're triple teaming Burston when she gets the ball into the corner. Matthew, that's how you beat the triple team. No good. Offensive rebound to Elia Bodie up and under. No, but she gets fouled.
Yeah, it'd be interesting how well Matthew really does tonight. Very good three-point shooter, and you said trying to triple-team Burston to cause a couple turnovers. It'll be interesting if she gets hot early.
Ilya Bodie, a 70% free throw shooter. And she knocks the first one down. Sub getting ready to come in for Ilya Bodie, trying to tell who, I believe that's, no, it's Katrina Edwards, getting ready to check in. Ilya Bodie's second shot, no good off the back rim. Trying to find the pass, Matthew steps up and swarms. Get to Vital. Bennett now on the wing. Denolfo into the post. Ilya Bodie with the defense, and she knocked her down. That was Petro who hit the deck.
Yeah, it'll be a good matchup to see Petro versus Ilya Bodie. Two very good presence down low for both teams.
And some size in that matchup. Petro, 5'11". Ilya Bodie, a six-footer. Vital gets a pick to her right. Burston fights through it. Here's the three-pointer. That one no good. Short from the near side wing from Purcell. Burston running the floor. Beacon's going to try to use some tempo. Jordan, three. No good. Rims out.
And you can see both teams are not afraid to take the three-pointer, which will be very exciting if they can start hitting some.
Bennett for two. No. Foul underneath. This one looks like it's going to go on Chantel Jordan. So that's one on Jordan, one on Matthew. Vital rebounds underneath. And a 5-second call on the Owls.
Trading turnovers and trading three-point attempts. Very even in both aspects so far.
Kind of what you expected out of this game. Although the Owls turn the ball over least of anybody in the conference. Runner no good, tipped back out. Chantel Jordan got a hand on it, but coming out of the pile is Vital. She loses it, back to Burston. Fresh clock for the Beacons. Burston back at the center court logo. Hobbs steps to her left. Gets it to Martiza Scott on the wing to Jordan, tries the bounce pass inside, it's taken away. Four turnovers for the Beacons, two for the Owls.
And last game against UMass Dartmouth, probably their first good half of the year. The Beacons really starting off slow with the first and second quarter last game. They played very well, not translating over to tonight.
Amanda Petro, 8.5 rebounds a game. She gets that put back to go. So it's 6-1. Jordan uses the ball, fake, gets a little bit of space, can't shoot. Matthew looking in the post. Out to Burston. Pick to her right in the corner. Matthew open three-pointer. She got it.
Katie Matthew, 30.8% from three-point line this year. She takes a lot of shots, but also makes a lot as well.
Purcell trying to answer, gets it to go. A little bit of a fade. Steve, that perked you right up.
Yeah, that was a great three-pointer. Obviously, very exciting, pushing the pace, and this could be a very high-scoring game if they start hitting some shots.
9-4, Owls on top, halfway through the first quarter. Jordan looks inside, uses the ball fake, gets it back to Burston. Matthew thought about the three, dribbles to her left, flips it back to Burston. Burston hesitates, drives the lane, kicks it out. Baseline jumper, no good. Rebound, Owls. Vital's going to run, gets it up ahead. This is Purcell through the double team. Offensive foul. And look how far, I can't tell who that is because she has the warm-ups on, but a little running man on the bench as we have a timeout on the floor. 4:47 to go in the first quarter. The visitors on top, but UMass Boston with some momentum. 9-4 your score. We will be right back on the Beacon Broadcast Network.
Division 3 allows you to give yourself to other things.
Having that free time allows me to pursue the things that I want to pursue.
Division 3 athletics affords students the opportunity to, you know, engage in the other interests in their campus and in their lives outside of that sport.
It allows you to just be able to do everything you want to do. how I wouldn't change it for the world.
Welcome back to the Clark Athletic Center. Alex Barth, Steve Witkowski. It is a 9-4 Owl lead. And Steve, let's go back and revisit that three-pointer. Sandy Purcell got to go.
Yeah, I mean, Purcell, a very good player, a very deep three, and kind of a little fadeaway action. A very exciting three-pointer for Keene State, but Katie Matthew did answer with another.
And then the Beacon strong, the offensive foul on the other side, maybe some momentum there. Kind of like to see them. It is early. It's not really drawn up plays at this point. But if they can come out with a three here, cut this to a two-point game, that'd be huge.
Yeah, a very unselfish Beacon team, to say the least. I think that every girl on that floor would take a charge for the team, and obviously Katie Matthew has done it tonight.
Beacons 1-for-5 from the field. Keene State 4-of-9. The turnovers 4-3. Beacons with the one extra giveaway. 6 of the 9 Owl points have come off turnovers. If the Beacons, and I mean, we said this a lot during the Rhode Island College game. You said it throughout the season. The Beacons can hold on to the ball a little bit better. It'll go ways in them having success in this game. They get it back to Chantel Jordan. Raven Kelsey now in the game for the first time. Kicks it out. Matthew's three-pointer is good.
And you talked about it, drawing up a play that you can get a wide-open three. There it is. Katie Matthew, three-pointer, 2nd of the game, 6 points out of the 7 points so far for the Beacons.
She's 2-for-2 from deep. We are 2-for-3 from deep. We have a foul away from the play. And Christina Ball wants an explanation.
Absolutely a wide-open three for Katie Matthew, and sinks it to put the Beacons within two.
That is the second foul on Chantel Jordan, something to keep an eye on. Lobbed all the way back over. Nice inbound play. Got to credit the design. Kenzie Bennett lays it up and in.
Yeah, wide open lay-in. I mean, you can't just have that if you're the Beacons. After such a huge basket to bring you within two, a wide open lay-in can't happen.
This is Edwards out to Burston. Kelsey wants the bounce pass inside. She has Jordan, leaves it for Edwards. Ball is loose on the floor. And now tied up again, yet another jump ball. That was Taje Burston who got tied up with Kenzie Bennett. It will be Owl's ball, I believe. No, Beacon ball.
And that's Taje's second jump ball of the night. Very, very good hustle player for the Beacons and very unselfish at point guard.
And now in traveling violation, I believe, was the call. Or an offensive foul. It's going to be Keene State ball either way. Here's Vital. Looking inside. Guarded by Burston. 15 on the shot clock. Moves to her right, gets a screen. Matthew comes up to help. Now it's Jordan pressuring the ball. Denolfo drives, left-handed layup, no good. Two Beacons fight over the rebound. They lose it. It gets kicked back out to Keene State with the fresh clock. Denolfo, guarded by Kelsey. Right-handed spin move. Now back to the left through the double team, and she's fouled.
And we talked about it. The Beacons have to be better rebounding. You saw there two Beacons go for the ball. None of them got it, which result to a foul and two free throws.
First time the Owls go to the line in this game. Denolfo, 70% free throw shooter.
And you talked about Denolfo before the game. Such a versatile player. Great free throw shooter. You really have to keep her off that stripe tonight.
First one off the backside of the rim and out. Both teams will substitute. Ariana Rivers into the game for the Beacons.
Yeah, Ariana Rivera, a great offensive player for the Beacons, has kind of caught fire in the last couple games, gaining a little bit of confidence. As you see, she travels there. Not on cue to what I was saying.
That is the 7th turnover of the game by the Beacons now.
7th turnover and only 7 points. For the Beacons, really struggling offensively so far.
Vital swings it to Denolfo. Nalfa back to Vital. Now they go to the post. No good. Rebound Rivera. She's hit on her way down. No call, but she's able to get the ball away. Beacons avoid disaster. It looked like Danolfo tried to just pull her down.
Yeah, no call either. That would have been a tough bid if there was a turnover.
Rivera to Kelsey. Kelsey on the elbow. One dribble gets it to Matthew on the wing. Thinks about the drive. Back across to Burston. Backdoor pass. Edwards backs her way in. She's fouled hard underneath.
And you can see it. We talked about it earlier. Taje Burston, a pass-first point guard. You got to see maybe with the loss of Grace Geary in the last couple games, maybe she becomes more of a shooter and more of a playmaker for the Beacons instead of just a passer.
She thought about the three there momentarily, but probably the right call to pass it up. Defense was closing quickly. Here's Burston again. Rivera's three. No good. It was halfway down and came out. Fight for the rebound near midcourt. Comes out with the Owls. Kick out. Trailer three. McPadden is good.
Another deep three for the Owls. You can't guard behind the NCAA sign. I mean, that's just impossible.
It's almost irresponsible because you're going to get beat going to the basket every time. Burston back to Kelsey. Kelsey step back. 18-foot jumper is blocked. Gets her own rebound. Underhanded layup and in. Great recovery by the junior from Boston, Massachusetts.
Great recovery, and she's been playing very good, especially against this Keene State team. 28 points, a career high, the last game they played.
Danolfo gets it back to Honorson. Vital's going to drive, kicks it out. Quick passing from the Owls, another three. This one no good from Emily McPadden.
Yeah, great ball movement by the Owls so far. Very unselfish, to say the least.
Burston back to Edwards. Edwards one dribble towards the basket. They're going to wave it off, foul on the floor. Michaela Eliabodi getting ready to check back in. And now coaching staff will bring her back to the bench. Guessing she was coming in for the shooter, Edwards.
And when the two teams played earlier this year, the score was 88-78.
First shot, no good from Edwards.
Very high scoring for women's basketball.
That game went to double overtime, I believe.
Double overtime, so it should be interesting. Obviously, not the most offensive game tonight, played with a lot of turnovers and missed baskets.
Quinones checks in for the Beacons. Second shot is good, and here comes Maritza Scott. So Scott back into the game. She replaces Edwards after she gets the two to fall at the stripe. McPadden. Danolfo. Not much you can do about that. Nice post move. 48 seconds remaining. Beacons can go 2-for-1 if they hurry. As we wind down the first quarter, Scott drives to the backup. Clean layup. And the Beacons will have the 2-for-1 unless the Owls get off a shot in the next 5 seconds.
Yeah, great move by Scott to really attack the basket there and get some points on the board before, obviously, for the 2-for-1.
Near side Vital on the pace. Kicks it out, 16-foot jumper, McPadden, no good back rim, offensive rebound, no good. Ball comes out near the Beacon bench, and it's scooped up by Raven Kelsey. 10 seconds on the clock. Beacon sprinting down the floor, 8 seconds. Person's going to drive, kicks it out, she's fouled. Owls did not have a foul to give, and it looks like Burston will go to the line. Burston, a 60% free throw shooter.
Yeah, a great move, obviously, by Taje to really draw that foul and attack the basket and make them kind of hack her so she can go to the line for two.
Burston converts them both, and now Christina Ball will get Katie Matthew in for the final 5 seconds. Beacons are going to press. Coming up the middle. Danolfo underneath at the buzzer. The layup is good. That was, trying to see the number when she turns around, number 34, Josie Amerson, who gets it to go. So that will do it. We're through one quarter. with the Owls leading 19-14 here on the Beacon Broadcast Network. For all things UMass Beacon Athletics, you can find us online at beaconathletics.com. We're on Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, and Instagram. Your score after one quarter, Keene State 19, UMass Boston 14. We'll be right back.
I'm a Division III student athlete, and I know how powerful words can be. The term gay doesn't mean stupid, lame, or less than.
So I pledge to speak up if I hear the term gay used in a derogatory way or any other homophobic terms.
If you can play, you can play in Division III.
I'm a Division III student athlete, and my teammates unconditionally accepted me as part of their family. So now I pledge to do the same for others. If you can play, you can play in Division III.
And back here at the Clark Athletic Center, Alex Barr, Steve Witkowski, bringing this one 19-14, the score after one quarter. Let's go back to that defense at the very end of the first quarter. First off, do you like the Owls using the foul there and getting burst into the line?
Obviously, I don't like I always believe that never put someone on the line, especially Taje Burston, one of the better free throw shootings for the Beacons. And you talked about it before, they usually foul the better free throw shooters for a team. Obviously, if I were Keene State, I would have let the clock kind of play out.
But risk the three-pointer.
Exactly. But, I mean, they did play, and then they got the basket at the end to kind of cancel it out.
Yeah, interesting not to see UMass Boston not leave anybody back on the press. Corner three from Vitale is good. Make it 22 for the Owls as they open up an eight-point lead, their largest of the game.
Yeah, we talked about it before. Both teams are very good at the three-point shot, so it wouldn't surprise me if one team really got hot.
Driving underneath is Scott. Her layup hits the bottom of the backboard. Owls coming the other way. Vitale this time the other corner. She gets it to go. 11-point lead for the Owls, and Christina Ball has to take a timeout. We'll take a timeout as well. 25-14. Just 42 seconds into the second quarter on the Beacon Broadcast Network.
I did receive a non-athletic scholarship upon entering school.
I got the presidential scholarship, which was huge for me.
I think there's more opportunities for academic scholarships in Division III.
I did receive academic scholarships. Just being involved on campus, being a leader, all those things combined kind of get me recognized. It's a great experience for me.
Back and an early timeout for Christina Ball, when you have to assume she did not want to take after back-to-back corner threes from Lydia Vitale.
Yeah, I mean, just a big playmaker, huge opportunity, puts them up by 11 points coming out of the first quarter. We talked about it. UMass Boston can't let the other team kind of dig the hole for them, and so they can't get out. And obviously down 11 right now, they need someone to step up and start shooting the basket at a high level.
Rebounding also starting to maybe be an issue for the Beacons. Each team has six defensive rebounds, but offensively, four boards on the offensive glass for the Owls, just one for the Beacons. A team that normally does pretty well on the offensive glass in UMass Boston as well. Here's Burston, gets it into the post to Scott. Maritza Scott's going to drive, layup no good. Sprinting up the other way. Kicked back, three-pointer. This time it's McPadden. Her shot's no good. Another offensive rebound from Petro, but it's quickly ripped away.
And another deep three by McPadden, almost to the NCAA sign, about 5 feet beyond the three-point line.
Burston puts up a three, rattles off the rim and out. 25-14, your score, 8:43 to go. Remember, the last couple times these teams have played, we've seen an 11-point first half comeback, a 20-point second half comeback. So we said in the open, just because a team gets up doesn't really mean much when it's the Owls and the Beacons as D'Onofrio's fouled underneath.
Yeah, I mean, it doesn't really mean much, but right now there's no offense for the Beacons, to say the least. I mean, only 14 points after 12 minutes of play. A lot of turnovers. Obviously, we're looking at 7 turnovers for the Beacons.
First shot is up and good from D'Onofrio. Beacons will change. Ilya Bodie's going to come in the game. Maritza Scott's going to get a chance to rest. Second shot, good as well. Extends it to a 13-point Keene State lead as they add on to their biggest margin of the afternoon. Knocked away. Burston's pass is knocked out of bounds by McPadden. Beacons will keep it as Coach Boucher has to chase that ball down back by the bleachers. Can I just say, as a guy wearing a sweater vest, Coach Boucher's sweater vest game, that red sweater game, so strong.
Yeah, I mean, you always look for a good sweater game out of a coach, and I'd say that's second to none.
Now, if only you had a bow tie.
Yeah, bow ties, that'll definitely put you over the top.
Quinona is going to try to drive to her right, and she walked. 8 turnovers.
Maybe a red bow tie with the red sweater vest. I think that'd be the best move.
Red with maybe some white polka dots.
I like where your head's at.
So the Owls coming back the other way, up 13, trying to add on to it. Vital thought about another three. She's been hot. This time it's the Beacons. They knock it away momentarily. It rolls over to the UMass Boston bench, but the ball will stay with the Owls.
And something the Beacons don't really have today is someone that is going to really take the ball and make something happen. It's just a lot of passing, a couple turnovers, no one really taking initiative and taking to the rack.
It looked like it was going to be Katie Matthews. She knocked down a couple threes early, but they haven't gone back to her since. Another three-pointer from the Owls is short. Another offensive rebound. Turnaround up. Got it to go. Bonanzio, Rachel Bonanzio, freshman from Middlebury, Connecticut.
They haven't really gotten back to her just because she's not really open. Every time you seem to see her get past to, it looks like a turnover for the Beacons.
Kelsey in the post. Too far for Elia Bodie. Trying to save it. It goes out of bounds off the Owls. Beacons will get an inbound with 19 seconds on the shot clock.
It'll be really interesting to see if they try to kind of look to Illabodi for her size to really have some dominance down low for some easy baskets.
They lob it out to Kelsey. Burston on the far side corner in front of the Owls bench. Into the post. Here is Illabodi. Draws the double team. Goes up with the layup through contact. No good. Out of bounds. Ball will stay down here. A fresh 30 coming for UMass Boston. Burston will inbound yet again.
And our player to watch, Raven Kelsey, is being guarded very tightly right now, not being able to get off a shot at all.
It's the defending conference defensive player of the year that is on her, Stephanie Dinolfo. Burston trying to drive baseline, loses the ball, gets it back, tries to kick it back to Ilya Bodie. It's stolen, a push called behind the play, and maybe helps the Beacons. The Owls would have been off and running.
Yeah, I mean, they had 2-on-1, obviously. Vitale was on Illabodi. A lot more speed.
7 minutes to go in the half. A 15-point out lead. The Beacons haven't scored since the Taje Burston free throws at the end of the first quarter.
And we talked about it at their last game against UMass Dartmouth. They struggled with a 19-2 run in the third quarter. The Beacons really have to spark some offense somehow, some way.
Burston gets a pick to her right. Kicks it back to Matthew. Matthew, nice spin move. Finds herself in the paint. Doesn't know what to do with it. Out to Burston now. Burston on the wing. Back to Matthew. Matthew Quinones, long two-pointer off the near side of the rim. No go.
And the Beacons, 4 of 13 from the field today. Not the percentage that you're looking for.
Dinolfo gives it back to Bonanzio. Shot doesn't even get the rim. Another offensive rebound for the Owls. Deep three-pointer. Almost had it. Still fighting for the board. Another offensive rebound. Thought about another three-point attempt, but Bonanzio gives it up.
And that's what's killing the Beacons right now. All the second chance, third chance, fourth chance opportunities for the Owls.
Steps to her right, now back. Over to McPadden. Offensive foul away from the play. 7 offensive rebounds for the Owls, just 5 second chance points. So it's not like you can say they've necessarily cashed in on everything. But again, the offensive rebounding a problem for a team in the Owls. It is the best offensive rebounding team in the league.
Yeah, I mean, we talked about it. Both teams are very good at three. Both teams are very good at defending the three. But the thing that's kind of changing the scoreboard right now is just rebounding and turnovers for the Beacons.
Giving the Owls extra possessions. Ilya Bodie tries to make her way in. Loses control. It's going to go down the other way. She saw Katie Matthew out of the corner of her eye open and had to make a quick decision to kick it out or keep it. The ball just got away from her. Ilya Bodie will now check out. And coming in is Katrina Edwards.
Yeah, she looks like she's really struggling today. Good defense by the Owls down low. Kind of batting the ball and just standing strong with the hands up, not fouling her.
Force more turnovers than anybody else. Purcell and a foul on the floor. I will say this, the Beacons have done a good job of keeping the Owls' leading scorer, Sandy Purcell, relatively quiet, one of two from the field. She knocked down a deep three-pointer, but that's pretty much it. Does have a couple assists. And she will inbound it underneath. Gets it out to Heen Thatch. Now in the post, Petro doesn't get it to go. Rebound, Raven Kelsey.
Heen Thatch not wearing a hairband. I mean, that was mentioned by one of our studio directors up here.
Laid up and in, and one. You can see Edwards fired up as the Beacons get their first field goal in almost 7 minutes.
Yeah, I mean, they need a spark somehow, some way. And if she hits this free throw, being down 12, It's better that they're starting to get something rolling here.
Edwards, one of two from the line so far today. And you mentioned Thatch not playing with her hair tied back and can be difficult.
Yeah, that was mentioned by our studio director up here. A good comment. I mean, the hair looks like it's going everywhere. Definitely a tough bid if you can't see where you're going on a basketball court.
Look, I had long hair in middle school, you know, like shoulder length, typical middle school grunge phase.
And okay.
I remember playing rec basketball, I was having a brush out. I can't imagine doing it with that.
Yeah, that's a lot of hair. And I always like to see where I'm going, especially on a basketball court.
Yeah, it helps in basketball to have a good field of vision. Traveling violation on the Owls, and suddenly the momentum meter is starting to tick back towards the Beacons. Chance to get it back within single digits on this possession here.
And Katrina Edwards, a very versatile player, especially down low. She needs to be a huge factor in this Beacons comeback.
Burston gets a screen to her right, guarded by Thatch. Into the post to Edwards. Just had the and one. Kicks it back out. Burston wanted to get it to Rivera. She's going to drive. Left-handed layup. Kisses it off the glass. No good. Rebound Owls. Up ahead, it's 2-on-1. Hesitation layup, no good. She put it too much off the rim. Ball rolling toward the sideline. Officials look at each other. Beacon ball. Missed a wide open breakaway layup.
And Burson, a 30% three-point shooter. I mean, I'd like to see her take a couple more threes. I mean, she has a couple wide open threes, but you could see she just looks to pass first.
0-for-2 from the field today, 0-for-1 from deep. She has hit a couple of free throws. Rivera. Guarded tightly at the line. Pick to her left. Drives in. Little runner. Oh, nice shot for the sophomore from Burlington, Massachusetts. How about that one?
Yeah, great shot. I mean, you're talking about getting on a little bit of a roll. 4-0 run for the Beacons.
Into the post. Petro gets it across. The pass is picked off. Burston. Up the floor. Steps back to the near side wing in the post to Edwards. Edwards, one dribble, up and under. It's waved off, she walked.
A great move, just one more step than she could have took.
Substitutions on the floor. Lydia Vital comes back in for the Owls, and Beacons bring back in Maritza Scott. And a timeout on the floor. We're going to step aside, 3:11 to go in the half. Beacons starting to get some momentum, but they are still down 10 here on the Beacon Broadcast Network.
Allows you to give yourself to other things.
Having that free time allows me to pursue the things that I want to pursue.
Division III athletics affords students the opportunity to, you know, engage in the other interests in their campus and in their lives outside of that sport.
It allows you to just be able to do everything you want to do. I wouldn't change it
to the world.
Welcome back. 3:11 to go in the second quarter. Alex Barth, Steve Witkowski. Thank you for spending part of your Saturday afternoon with us for game one of this doubleheader. 20 minutes following this one, Beacon's men will take on the Keene State men. In another game, two teams right in the thick of things, middle of the conference. Big standing indications, maybe rights to host a playoff series at stake. Thrown out to the far side, Purcell. Back near side to Vitale, guarded by Burston. Back out to Purcell, now in the corner. Driving in. Denolfo, turn around, no. Offensive rebound, another one for the Owls. Petro against four defenders, kicked back out. Vitale, three, looks good, just missed. Another offensive rebound. Denolfo is going to bring it out and reset with 27 on the shot clock. Near side to Vitale, gets it into the post. Bennett steps back out beyond the three. Vitale with 2:30 to go in the quarter. Denolfo against Kelsey, kicks it out. Vitale, guarded by Burston, steps back. 10 on the shot clock, 8 seconds. Vitale gets a pick to her right. She's going to use it at the free throw line. Kicks it to the corner. Purcell, three, no good. Rebound Beacons, a great defensive stand despite giving the Owls two or three chances.
Yeah, great defensive stand. A lot of three-pointer shot on that. Just a tough way to go about not rebounding.
Under two to go now in the half. Burston out, three-pointer. Matthew looks good. Back rim doesn't get the bounce. Foul on the floor, and the Beacons will keep it. Foul goes on Petro, her second. Make it 9 offensive rebounds for the Owls. They have almost as many offensive rebounds as they do defensive, 10-9.
And someone that is not afraid to shoot it is Vitale. I mean, taking a couple three-pointers right there, just missing, obviously connecting with two earlier today.
Josie Amerson checks into the game. A travel on Matthew would have had Rivera open for three. 1:46 to go in the half.
Down 10, just looking to get it within 5 in the next 2 minutes for the Beacons.
Vitale steps back to Bennett, now gets it over to Denolfo. Denolfo pump fakes, back to Vitale, guarded by Burston. Pick to the right, kicks it out to Bennett. Kenzie Bennett gives it off. And Purcell was whacked on her way to the basket. The foul, I believe, will go on the floor. Although the Owls seemed to think initially it was going to be a free throw, the inbound will actually come from the far side. Denolfo with it, guarded by Matthew, gets it to the wing. Purcell, and it's waved off. Foul on the floor, another one on the Beacons. That is 7 fouls for the Beacons. Well, that'll be their 8th. Total in the game, 9 for Keene State. And the Beacons did not have a foul to give. It will send Josie Amerson to the line, but just a 40% free throw shooter, a shade under 40, is Amerson. Sophomore from Hawthorne, New York.
A relatively good foul by the Beacons. I mean, obviously a 40%. Well,
first one is good.
Spoke,
you know,
a little
40%
bit
means she's hit a couple of them.
Spoke a little bit too early.
An interesting form, a little bit off balance, almost lunges forward with the ball. Raven Kelsey checks out of the game. Elia Bodie back in for the Beacons. Amerson's second, no good off the back rim. Denolfo almost had the 10th offensive rebound of the game for the Owls, but the ball knocks off her hands and goes out of bounds. Make sure you stay with it at halftime. We will talk to head coach Christina Baugh and break down the first half as well as look ahead to the second half and game two of our doubleheader. So keep it with Steve and I. After the next minute, 4. Burston gets it into the post. Elia Bodie. Back out to Burston. Steps to her left. Kicks it back to Scott. Scott's floater. Offensive. Oh, no. Defensive. What are they going to call this? And we have a player down. As up to her feet is Denolfo now, a little bit slowly. It was a defensive foul.
Keene
so
State
Scott to the line.
Keene State thought it was offensive. It looked like she was moving her feet just a tad obviously enough to get the call.
Might have been in the circle as well. Scott's first free throw is good. And that gets the Beacons back within 10, can cut it down to single digits here with 54 seconds to go in the quarter. Front rimmed it. Rebound comes to McPad and gets it to Purcell. Purcell with 47 on the clock. The Owls can get a 2-for-1 here. Purcell tries to drive, kicks it out, near side, into the corner. Vitale has the open three. She likes the corner, can't get that one to go. Ball will stay here. She's missed her last couple of threes after being hot early. Lydia Vitale now 2 of 6 from deep.
And another second point chance for the Keene State Owls, obviously. A tough first half for the Beacons rebounding, and they got to do something in the locker room to change that.
Purcell. Bounce pass inside. Owls are going to get back to the line with 29.4 to go.
I mean, usually when you're on the defensive side more than not, you're going to foul more than not. So, I mean, this is no surprise. Another Keene State Owl going to the line.
Oh, the Owls actually have more fouls in this game than the Beacons do, 10-9. First free throw is good from Purcell, just her fourth point of the game, 1 of 3 from the field, all deep. That's her first trip to the line. A terrific free throw shooter, 81% from the stripe, and she gets them both to go there. Beacons will bring Raven Kelsey back in for what should be, I would imagine, the final possession of the half. I would think they would just try to get this back within 10 going to the locker room. Burston back to Kelsey, 20 seconds on the clock. Kelsey to Matthew. Off a screen back to Burston, 13 seconds, back out to Kelsey. 10 seconds on the clock. Raven Kelsey's going to drive, pulls up in traffic, no good. Rebound Owls, 5 seconds. If they can run, they can get it. Here comes Purcell. She's going to get a look at a three. Instead, she drives. The ball's knocked away by Raven Kelsey. And that will do it for the first half. She could have pulled up if she wanted, but Purcell wanted the layup. We head to the break with Keene State on top, 32-20. We're going to go for away real quick, but keep it here. I will be back momentarily talking with head coach Christina Baugh. In the meantime, you can check us out online for updates on this game, the upcoming men's game, and all things Beacons Athletics. Visit beaconsathletics.com, and we will be right back.
What separates UMass Boston from other schools is the fact that a large percentage of students commute. For me, it takes 2 hours each day to go to and from school, but every second has been worth it because the students that come here are serious about learning, they value their education, and understand where it'll take them in the future. This is what UMass Boston means to me.
Joined by Coach Ball and Coach, they're getting you on the offensive glass, as many offensive rebounds as defensive. What do you guys need to do to fix that?
We got to box out. You know, our bench has to be a little better at yelling the word shot, because we're not seeing the ball right now as far as being in our gaps and being able to lock up. So we can't give 10, you know, second chance at 7-1. Probably should be 14-1. So we have to do a better job of boxing out, and Petro's given us everything she's got. So maybe we got to put two on her, but we got to do a better job cleaning it up on the glass.
Turnover-wise, you guys had a little bit of trouble at the beginning. It seems like you kind of got it under control as the half went on. Did you make any adjustments, or was that just getting into the flow of the game?
Just getting into the flow of the game. But, we have 12 right now. That's way too many. We've only taken 19 shots. It's going to be really hard to win if we can't take maybe 40 shots this half. Last game we took 78. So we're not aggressive on the offensive glass as well as in our offense, period.
Speaking of being aggressive on offense, Kate Matthew knocked down a couple threes early. Then you guys kind of went away from her. You can look to go to in the second half and light a spark?
Absolutely, man. When we reverse the ball and get more than five passes, we get whatever we want. So we got to get back to that.
Thank you very much, Coach. Keep it here. We'll break down the second half, the first half, and go look ahead to the second half right after this break.
Saving, you're right. Brett Mason keeping that thing was trickling in.
A little bit behind it. Super D for Sibley. Nothing on the shot. Rebound tipped home by Daly.
Nursery, rhyming, hickory, dickory, blowing that sour, the hood call it pickery, Biggie, Puffy, Buster, Victory.
So I got the Audemars, flawless diamonds. In other words, that's called perfect timing. I feel like a favor, I feel like a savior. The clock on my neck, I feel like a flavor. I go so hard,
with Lindsay going up the street.
Welcome back. Halftime coverage here. Beacons currently trailing 32-20. Alex Barth, Steve Witkowski bringing you this one. Let's take a look at the stats at halftime. And Steve, you pointed out to me before, points off turnovers, points off offensive rebounds. Not looking good for the Beacons.
No, not looking good at all. Obviously, she talked about it. 8 turnovers. Obviously, Keene State has 10 points off turnovers. Let me retract my statement there. 12 turnovers for the Beacons and 10 points off turnovers. I mean, it's only a 12-point game, and obviously in a conference game like this, a very important game for the Beacons, not playing well and not playing clean at all.
So a basketball coach once told me there are things called unnecessary points, as you see the breakdown right there. Unnecessary points is when you add up points off turnovers and points off offensive rebounds. They're points that weren't necessary for you to give up. Beacons right now have given up 17 unnecessary points, 10 off turnovers, 7 off offensive rebounds, and they've only scored 4 unnecessary points of their own. So that's a 12 points swing. What's the difference on the scoreboard, Steve?
Yeah, well, it's 12 points exactly. I mean, Coach Baugh kind of said that she needs the bench to be a little bit louder.
Yeah, that was interesting that she, I don't want to say blamed, but she brought up the bench when it talks about the offensive rebounding.
Yeah, I mean, the bench, I mean, they have 8 points to the other team's 8 points off the bench, so it looks like they brought the energy. I guess they need to do a little bit better on yelling shot because they can't see it. I think the Beacons just really have to bring the intensity level in the second half
and
all around.
She talked about, Coach Baugh talked about how Amanda Petro was killing them as we take a look at the individual leaders. And you'll see Petro here on the glass. It almost seems like the defenders are so worried about her, they're getting their head up late to see the rebound. Maybe that's why they're having trouble seeing the ball. Denolfo already on double-double watch, as you can see right there. Katie Matthew, the 6 points, both came very early in the first quarter on a couple of threes. You heard Coach Baugh say they want to get her the ball back, swing it around a little more. 5 passes is the key, so let's keep an eye on when they come back out for the half how many times the Beacons are passing the ball on their possessions.
Yeah, I mean, in Keene State, their ball movement is impeccable right now. I mean, you could watch that after they got that offensive rebound, they kind of slow down the clock. And really try to get the most of their possession that they really have.
So we're going to take a look back at the first half highlights right now. When we come back, we'll take a look around the conference and around Beaconville. Get you ready for the second half. Keep it here. It's Alex Barth and Steve Witkowski at halftime on the Beacon Broadcast Network. Welcome back here to the Clark Athletic Center. 4 minutes left in halftime on the dot. Wow, I hit that well. 32-20, Keene State Owls lead as the Beacons try to put together the third double-digit comeback we've seen in this series in the last 3 games, Steve. And what do they need to do it?
I mean, they need to solidify someone. Well, someone has to step up. I mean, we talked about Raven Kelsey before the game. Katrina Edwards had her moment, and Katie Matthews had her moment in this game. But, I mean, Beacons, there's only Katie Matthew obviously has 6. Maritza Scott is with 3, and Katrina Edwards has 4. So not a lot of offense on the Beacon side. Someone's really got to step up, and Raven Kelsey only with 2 points today.
The Owls back out on the floor. We're just waiting on the Beacons. Well, we do. Let's take a look around the Little East Conference this afternoon. What's going on, doubleheaders? All over the Northeast, Rhode Island College and Eastern Connecticut State. It's the cream of the crop at the top of the conference, Eastern Connecticut, and they are up 36-22 at halftime. Southern Maine and Western Connecticut are underway. We do not have a score for that one for you. UMass Dartmouth and Plymouth State are tied, and that could be a big one because UMass Dartmouth, second in the conference, Plymouth State down in 6. A Plymouth State loss would give the Beacons some serious breathing room, but a UMass Dartmouth loss and a UMass Boston win would put them within earshot, within a game of second place as things start to wrap up. The Beacons in the five spot right now. Keene is in third. A Beacons win would tie these two teams. The tiebreaker would give it to the Beacons, and that could be the difference between the Beacons hosting in the first round or not.
Yeah, I mean, we talked about it. It's the end of the season, and everything's coming down the line. So I think the Beacons really have to worry about this game right now and worry about how are they going to get back in this game. We talked about it. They're digging themselves a lot of holes, and they really haven't been able to dig out, especially against UMass Dartmouth.
We'll keep you posted on those scores throughout the game. Meanwhile, what's going on around Beaconville as well, we take a look. And for updates on all of this, remember, you can find us online at beaconsathletics.com, on Twitter at UMass Beacons. We're also on Facebook, YouTube, and Instagram. Like we talked about, first half of a doubleheader. Men's basketball host Keene State at 3 o'clock or approximately 20 minutes after this game ends. Last night, women's hockey, a 3-0 loss to Holy Cross, a tough one for the Beacons. Men's hockey is at Daniel Webster this afternoon at 3:05. Big game for them over there.
Yeah, obviously, men's hockey lost last night against Southern Maine. A tough loss, 4-3. They're trying to get back on the horse. Only a couple more weekends. And a team that went to the final Frozen Four last year, struggling as of late. So it should be interesting if they get back on their horse today against a depleted Daniel Webster team.
We're going to step aside when we come back. Second half action. Keep it here on the Beacon Broadcast Network.
What separates UMass Boston from other schools is the fact that a large percentage of students commute. For me, it takes 2 hours each day to go to and from school. But every second has been worth it because the students that come here are serious about learning, they value their education, and understand where it'll take them in the future. This is what UMass Boston means to me.
And we're back here at the Clark Athletic Center, getting ready for the second half. Teams will switch sides as we get it started. Field goal percentage, Christina Vaughn mentioned, there's only 19 shots taken by the Beacons. They took more than 70 in their last game. And, I mean, the turnovers will help with that, but 6-for-19 from the field is something that needs to go up.
Yeah, we talked about it, Grace Geary not being here, one of the better shooters. Someone's got to step up, and we talked about it a lot, and nothing's really happened in the last quarter. Raven Kelsey, 2 points, not starting in this second half. So, I mean, Maritza Scott can drive the lane. Taje Burston can take the shot, but pass-first mentality. It'll be interesting to see if she starts taking more shots in the second half.
The other thing we mentioned at the top of the broadcast, these are two of the best three-point shooting teams in the conference, but two of the best three-point defending teams in the conference. So we have a five-second call underneath. Well, the three-point defense has won out. Owls are 4-14. The Beacons are 2-7. As we get started here, the team switch sides. Like I mentioned, if you're just joining us, Keene State, the road reds with white trim. They will move left to right across your screen. Beacons in their home whites moving right to left. That shot, Beacons got in front, knocked it away, but another offensive rebound for the Owls. I didn't hear the bench there, Steve.
Another
kick to the middle, kick back to Vital.
Another second chance opportunity, and I mean, the bench, well, I didn't hear them either. So, I mean, the intensity needs to be brought if the Beacons want to win this game.
And now all the way down on the other side of the floor, so they're going to have to get extra loud. In the corner, three-pointer, no good. And the Beacons hesitant to get that rebound. Chantel Jordan comes in and gets the jump ball. The ball's going to stay here, though. There were three Beacons under the basket. None of them made a move on the ball. The Owls were able to just swoop in and grab it.
Yeah, I mean, Coach Harris, the men's basketball team, talks about it all the time. Rebounding is awarding the aggressor. Getting a rebound is the aggressive person kind of taking the initiative. It doesn't matter size, weight, height, and the Beacons are just not very aggressive right now under the boards.
A foul underneath. Going to the line for the Owls is Kenzie Bennett, a 70% free throw shooter. Bennett's first trip to the line today. Gets that one to go. She's 1-4 from the field. Also has a couple of rebounds. Freshman forward from Lake George, New York. Get the second one to go. 34-20, your score, 9:06 to go.
Good vacation spot for a good vacation in the summer, Lake George, New York.
You always wonder about those spots. Like the Cape is like that, too. Cape Cod, Massachusetts. It's a great vacation spot. What's it like to live there in the summer? Does the charm wear off? That's where you're from.
The winter, yeah. I mean, Lake George, New York, in the mountains. A lot of snow. Definitely a tough place in the winter.
It's a big skiing place, too, isn't it? As the Beacons get their own offensive rebound as we're yapping, and Maritza Scott's going to have an and-one opportunity.
Yeah, I mean, that's what the Beacons need. They need second-chance opportunities, obviously, with Keene State getting those opportunities. The Beacons need that as well.
Scott, one of two from the stripe today. No good.
And free points for the Beacons. Obviously, free throws need to be hit to get back in this game as well.
To the corner, contested three, no good. Takes a big hop out right to Chantel Jordan. She's going to run. The Owls have numbers defensively, and Jordan will double back around. Gets it over to Burston. Burston to her left, tries to go underneath. Turned over again.
And you've really seen that all night. The Beacons not very good in transition like they usually are.
High up off the glass. And it's Denolfo getting it to go. Denolfo now up to 9 points. Thrown inside. Scott on the back door cut.
Great pass by Katie Matthew to find Scott on the lay-in.
Remember what Coach Ball talked about halftime, making crisp passes. If they get five passes, they'll get whatever they want. That's what she told me. Only one pass right there, but it was crisp. Floater no good. Goes in and out of the hands of Matthew. Fought for on the ground. It's going to be another jump ball. And this one should go with the Beacons.
You can hear the Keene State coach a little displeased on the fact that there was a ball on the floor and Keene State didn't jump on it.
Katrina Edwards checks into the game, replaces Michaela Iliabodi.
And going forward for this Beacons team, I think Iliabodi needs to really work on and practice on being a better post player. A lot of size, a lot of talent, just doesn't have the touch down low yet.
Inside Scott again, she has it stripped. This one's going to go on Burston. She tried to take the charge coming back the other way. First foul on Burston. Couple Beacons in foul trouble. Ariana Rivera with three, Chantel Jordan with three. And nobody with more than two for the Owls.
Yeah, not a very deep bench for the Beacons. Obviously, only about three players that really play off that bench.
That is the one thing the Owls have really working in their advantage is this one's lobbed into the post. Up and under move is no good. And another jump ball. Or are we going to get an over-the-back foul? I believe we are. When we did that game against Rhode Island College, Steve, remember, they had players getting hurt. And we realized they only had about seven or eight players active. Keene State, one of the biggest rosters I remember seeing in 5 years calling D3 women's basketball. The men's roster, it's the size of a men's roster, which is normally four or five players bigger.
Yeah, I mean, you can see that kind of later in the game, especially when you keep five of the same players out there the whole time.
17 listed, not all are dressed for the Owls. But it helps to have numbers. I believe all have gotten into a game at some point this year. Purcell off the spin, underhand layup. And an offensive foul. I believe that's the second offensive foul on Purcell. A couple offensive fouls in this game for the Owls. They've been aggressive, though. You can't fault them.
Yeah, you can't fault them there. I mean, they're driving to the rack, kind of creating something. The Beacons really need to start scoring some points here in the second half.
Foul on the floor. It's going to go on the Owls.
And four fouls already here in the first quarter. So that'll be interesting to see as the quarter kind of rolls on and how many times the Beacons really do go to the line and how many free throws they actually do execute on.
Sandy Purcell checks out of the game. Owls leading scorer on the bench. Beacons down 12, 6:25 to go in the third. Trying to get this comeback going. Katie Matthew off the backdoor cut. Back out to Burston. Thought about shooting it. Doesn't. Instead takes the runner. Gets it to go.
Yeah, I mean, I was looking at you right there. I really wanted to see her take the three-point shot. But obviously a great move by her and a huge basket for the Beacons.
Patience is a virtue there, Steve. Matthew defending Denolfo, playing off the ball in the corner. Vital, talk about somebody who doesn't have trouble taking threes. Vital misses again, now 2 of 8 from deep.
Yeah, not afraid, obviously, but 2 of 8 is not the percentage that you really want as a shooter.
Scott's fouled in the lane. She'll go to the line. Not only 2 of 8 from deep, Vital, 2 of 8, period. Not even contemplating a two-pointer.
Well, some people just live behind the three-point mark, and you can see that's her tonight. That was me in eighth grade basketball. A little information for our fans out there.
You were the dead eye?
Yeah, I used to have the goggles. They called me Wild Thing.
There you go.
Never made a three-pointer, just took a lot of them.
You know, I only hit one, but it was a half-court, end-of-the-quarter shot that I had no business making. No, give me like a real shot? No, not going on. Denolfo with it. Gives it back around to McPadden. McPadden out to Bonanzo. Guarded tight. Pass into the post. Player on the floor for the Beacons and getting up slowly. It looks like that's Maritza Scott. She's still down behind the play. Beacons 5-on-4. She'll get up and limp down the floor and calling for a timeout as Christina Baugh telling the official to stop the game as Scott's going to make her way slowly over to the bench. Raven Kelsey's going to replace her. They didn't see anything that looked particularly bad. Scott did fall hard, but she walks off under her own power, takes a seat on the bench. Training staff not talking to her. We'll keep an eye on it.
Kelsey, obviously only 2 points tonight, 28 the last game.
Edwards' layup is good.
We'll see if she gets involved in the offense and really starts getting in there for offensive points.
Scott looks like he's tying her shoe. Did she trip over her shoelace? Is that what happened?
That's a good question. We might be able to go back to the replay on that one, but I don't know if we'd want to see that replay.
Got
to
keep those shoes tied. Matthew, guarding Denolfo, drives to her right, throws it way out on the corner. And the Beacons will get the ball. There's turnovers, and then there's that.
Yeah, and turnovers have been a topic of tonight, obviously, with the Beacons with 15. But Keene State already having 9. I think they came into the second half with 6. So the Beacons going on a little bit of a run here because Keene State offensively has been not there.
Timeout on the floor. We will step away. We'll come back. Final 4:48 of the third. Owls on top, 36-29.
Division III allows you to give yourself to other things.
Having that free time allows me to pursue the things that I want to pursue.
Division III athletics affords students the opportunity to, you know, engage in the other interests in their campus and in their lives outside of that sport.
It allows you to just be able to do everything you want to do. I wouldn't change it for the world.
Welcome back. 36-29, your score. Steve, that last turnover by the Owls. You've seen the video of Lance Stevenson. He tries to throw a pass to the corner and drills a woman in the head in the stands.
Yeah, luckily that only went to the Keene State bench, so no fans hurt in the process.
They were ready for it, too. You know, it's the red sweater. It looks like a jersey. She's trying to pass it to the coach. Beacons will inbound in front of the Keene State bench as we get going again. 4:46 to go in the third quarter. Burston hop stepping to jump up to the top of the arc. Gets it in the post. Kelsey backs her way down. She was grabbed. Raven Kelsey will go to the line. First time today.
Yeah, and you can see that maybe she's going to start driving the basket, making something happen, and that's going to be huge for the Beacons if she does start becoming a scorer for this team.
Today's officials, Paul Semikow, Christine Sampson, and Ron Bouchard. Called a pretty even one today, I think. Nothing to complain about. First one is good.
Nothing to complain about. Nothing too much. Nothing too little. A couple weekends ago, I felt like I was here for 4.5 hours for the women's basketball game. Just fouls every other second.
You know, when you don't even notice the refs until you realize you haven't noticed them, it's normally a good sign.
You usually can't win as a ref, to say the least.
In the post. DeNolfo underneath. No, but she was fouled. DeNolfo has had trouble, averages 11 points per game, but the defense has been able to keep her relatively in check from the field. It's at the line where she's gotten it done, 3 for 4, and a chance to go back here. Gets it to go, and that's 10.
And with consistent scores, I mean, that's one of their probably standpoints when you're not hitting from the field. To be dynamic from the free throw line, that's just automatic points.
DeNolfo's second is good. Now a rebound away from a double-double. Burston head on a swivel into the post. Edwards. Two dribbles, tries to kick it out, gets the ball back, rolls it back to Burston, has to keep it in bounds on the floor now, trying to get it away, and a timeout called.
And you credit DeNolfo's offensive ability. She's been on Raven Kelsey all night. Raven Kelsey, 28 points the last time they played, only 4 points tonight, and two of them coming off free throws.
We'll keep it here with 4:08 to go in this timeout, 38-31, a 7-point deficit now for the Beacons.
I did receive a non-athletic scholarship.
Who are now in the bonus as well.
I got the presidential scholarship, which was huge.
And an extra timeout kind of gifted here.
I think there's more opportunity.
With the ball rolling away. And a nice play from Burston to keep that ball alive.
Yeah, I mean, obviously we talked about it. Senior for the Beacons, obviously a leader, unselfish, and sportsmanship is definitely a key to her game.
Make sure you keep it with us post-game. We will have instant reaction from Christina Baugh, and we'll break it down. And after this game, 20 minutes after this game, the men's team will take on Keene State. And not to get too ahead of ourselves, Steve, what are you looking for in that one?
I mean, it's going to be a great game. Obviously, Keene State at the top of the division for the Little East Conference, a very good conference. And UMass Boston struggling as of late, a couple losses in a row. So we'll see if they can kind of bounce back, especially a couple conference losses in a row where they saw themselves at the top of the division. Now they're kind of at the lower tier with the recent losses. But obviously a lot of time to kind of make that ground up with 5 or 6 games left on their schedule. A good time to get hot for the Beacons.
Beacons will inbound in front of their own bench. It's Burston trying to get it into Matthew. She does. Matthew drives to the baseline, kicks it out. Kelsey trying to get inside, hit off a foot, rolled clean. Keene State comes out with it.
Another turnover for the Beacons, and you can't have that if you're trying to go an offensive run.
And that's their 16th turnover. Keene State has 10. Vitale gives it back to McPadden. McPadden back to Vitale. Now in the post, up and under, and Emerson was fouled. She'll go to the line, 1 for 2 today.
It really has been a predominantly defensive-oriented game tonight for both sides. Both sides shooting under 40%. Beacons with 38.5 and Keene State Owls with 31.6. And you mentioned the turnovers before.
Last time these teams met as the first one is good. So Emerson helping out her cause was a 38.5% free throw shooter coming into it. Now 2 of 3. That number might go up above 40. I don't know how big the sample size is there, but last time these teams met, an 88-78 game. Granted, it wasn't double overtime, but a little more defensive this time around.
And Katrina Edwards hobbles off the court. You'd hate to see that as a Beacon fan.
Chantel Jordan back in the game with 3 fouls. Scott's going to set her pick to the right. Jordan goes to her left. Offensive foul. And that's 4 on Jordan. She comes in and quickly picks it up.
And, I mean, Chantel Jordan with 4, and you look at Katrina Edwards behind the bench for the Beacons, kind of trying to run off. It looks like a cramp. Rivera about to check in.
Meanwhile, Maritza Scott, after going down hard earlier, is back in the game, appears to be moving fine as she actually gets in front there and denies that layup, but a little late getting up. DeNolfo in the corner, bounce pass. No good, another wide open layup missed by Emerson. Fight for the ball underneath. Burston looked like came out with it, but not soon enough. It's going to be a jump ball.
Yeah, great pass by DeNolfo. I mean, We've talked about her offensive abilities by scoring, her defensive abilities, but also her passing abilities are second to none as well.
So the Beacons got it within six, but are now back down nine after trailing by as many as 15. Jumper from the elbow, no good. Another offensive rebound. Benanzio. Make it 13 offensive rebounds. They're pretty much one for one. Offensive to defensive rebounds is Keene State. You can tell today why they're the top offensive rebounding team in the conference. Step back three-pointer, Vital bricks it.
Bricks it's an understatement. Vital right now, she's at 2 of 9 tonight.
Into the post, Scott. Try to get it across to Edwards, didn't put enough on it. Gets her own pass back, but there's four owls right there as she hit the deck. Coming back the other way and a foul. No, it traveled before. It looked like they were trying to intentionally foul Amerson before she could get the shot up, but she walked. Both teams now in the bonus after that foul, so next time the Owls will go to the line.
And you talk about the fact that the offensive rebounding and the rebounding has really been a huge move for Keene State. Katrina Edwards not on the floor. Michaela Illabodi not on the floor. So the Beacons playing with a really small lineup.
Kelsey's three is good. Raven Kelsey. The tray ball brings the Beacons within six.
And she can get hot from behind the arc. It'll be interesting to see how close D'Alfo really starts to guard Raven Kelsey.
Doesn't take many, but when she does, a 35% shooter from deep and a push away from the ball. This is going to go against the Beacons. That is the 16th foul on the Beacons. 16 fouls for each team now. And going to the line is Benanzio. Third foul on Katie Matthews, so she joins a couple of the Beacons in foul trouble. First one is good.
Benanzio, 50% free throw shooter, knocks the first one down.
Talked about Katrina Edwards earlier dealing with what appeared to be some sort of cramp. She's now back in the game. Looks to be okay. She replaces Maritza Scott. Second one from Benanzio, good as well. 8-point lead now for the Owls, 42-34, 1:43 to go in the third. Burston calls the play, steps to her right. Cross-court pass, Rivera gets by one defender, tries to put it up from the baseline, shot is blocked, it will stay here.
Defense has really been there for the Keene State Owls. All the turnovers, block shots, great defensive play, and Raven Kelsey has been shut down. We'll see if she can kind of wiggle out and get a couple shots off.
Kelsey puts the ball on the floor, draws the double, takes the contested pull-up, trying to draw the foul, no good off the side of the backboard. Rebound Keene State with the shot clock winding down. Probably the best look the Beacons had. To the corner, Vital hesitates, now back up to the top of the arc. 1:05 to go in the quarter, 19 seconds remaining on the shot clock. And D'Alfo is fouled by Katie Matthews. She now has four. And quickly, Alicia Quinones is going to come to the table. And I wouldn't be surprised if they'll take Matthew out here and make sure she's still available for a late game run from deep.
Yeah, Chantel Jordan, obviously Katie Matthew. The Beacons are in a serious amount of foul trouble tonight.
And there was a fan in the front row who had been a little bit vocal. It seemed to be within reason, but the officials come over and warn him. And I believe if another warning is given to the fans, it would be a technical against the Beacons. I believe that's the rule.
You hate to see that, especially as a Beacon basketball player, a father, any kind of fan. You really don't want them changing the outcome of this game.
Burston comes up the floor, 56 seconds to go. Right-handed dribble gets it to Kelsey. Now to Rivera in the post. Edwards. Edwards uses the jab step, draws the double, trying to get free underneath, falling down, turns it over. 40 seconds left in the quarter. Driving Vitale, no good, but she's fouled. Finally takes it two, and she gets herself to the line. Lydia Vitale, a chance to score for the first time since early in the first quarter when she knocked down a couple of threes.
And this Keene State Owls bench so deep. You got to see that kind of coming into play with the Beacons team, obviously in foul trouble and obviously very tired at this point for all the players kind of playing the whole game.
Vitale gets those two to go. It's back to a double-digit lead for the Owls with 37 seconds to go in the quarter. Burst into her right. Kicks it back. Quinones. The up and under. No, but she was fouled. Got a couple steps there. The freshman from Stoughton, Massachusetts. Played her high school ball for the Knights of Stoughton High in the Hockomaw Conference. First one is good. Interesting Hockomock League connection in our second game. Jimmy Lehman is a forward from Keene State. If the name Lehman sounds familiar to you, played his high school ball at King Philip, where his brother also played, Portland Trailblazers forward Jake Lehman. Graduate of University of Maryland. Here comes Heem Thatch and quickly gives it off to Denolfo. 13 seconds on the clock. Shot clock is off. Kelsey on Denolfo. Strength on strength. 8 seconds. Trying to force Denolfo to go right. She does. Kicks it off. Trying to get it back out. Three-pointer at the buzzer. It's good. Emily McPadden extends the lead back to double digits. And as we make the turn for home, it's Keene State 48. Beacons 36. We'll step aside for 30 seconds and be back with the conclusion. Keep it here on the Beacon Broadcast Network.
Division III allows you to give yourself to other things.
Having that free time allows me to pursue the things that I want to pursue.
Division III athletics affords students the opportunity to, you know, engage in the other interests in their campus and in their lives outside of that sport.
It allows you to just be able to do everything you want to do. I wouldn't change it for the world.
Back here at the Clark Athletic Center. As we get ready for the fourth quarter, we'd like to remind you for updates on all things Beacons Athletics, you can find us online, beaconathletics.com. We're on Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, and Instagram. Real quick, a look at the Little East Conference scoreboard. See what's going on around the conference. And being told we don't have that right now, but we'll get that to you.
Let's go back to the game. A very deep three by McPadden. She's been taking them all night. Denolfo forced to her right, passes it out, then to McPadden, and just knocked down a very deep three to put him up by 12.
Finally gets it to go. Now 2 of 9 from the field, 2 of 6 from deep. Owls take a lot of threes. They're 15 of 20 from beyond the arc. 20 of 43 shots have been three-pointers. Burston. Oh, look at that. Nice reverse move. Layup for two. Taje Burston gets the Beacons back within 10. Vitale on Burston. Gets a pick to her right. Near side to Nolfo. Kicked out. Vitale going to take a deep three. No.
The Beacons look like they've stopped guarding Vitale after she is 2 of 10 from the free three-point line. Ice cold as of late.
Foul on the floor after the shot by Keene State, so the Beacons will get the inbound. They did get the rebound, though. The rebounding differential, 29-23, advantage Owls. But the offensive rebounds, 14-5 in favor of Keene State. Canonis tries to drive. She is fouled.
And another quick two fouls by Keene State. You saw it last quarter. Came out with a lot of fouls. It resulted to a couple Beacons free throws.
Sandy Purcell has three fouls. She sat out most of the end of that third quarter, the leading scorer. Amanda Petro has three fouls. So does Kenzie Bennett. Up and in. Beacons get it back within eight.
Beacons on a 4-0 run right now.
Wants to get it to Purcell. There it is. Takes the three-pointer. Hand in her face. Gets it to go. Sandy Purcell back in the game. Knocks one down. She's got 8 points. Burston over to Raven Kelsey. Kelsey to Quinones. Inside to Edwards. Edwards trying to drive baseline. Defended tight. Rivera's going to tee it up for three. No. Offensive rebound, Raven Kelsey. Foul on the floor. Beacons will keep it. May have called over the back as Kelsey was able to box out and grab that board.
And Keene State, obviously a very good three-point shooting team. We've mentioned it many times tonight. They can extend their lead with the three-pointer. And the Beacons really haven't been able to shorten Keene State's lead with the three-point game.
Now to Edwards. To Burston. Kelsey behind the arc already has 1-3. Rivera's going to drive with the right hand. Gives it back to Burston. Near side wing. 15 on the shot clock. She's hacked. Now three quick fouls on the Owls. And let me tell you something. If this starts turning into a free throw game, we're going to remember these early fouls. This is the way the Beacons got back in it.
Yeah, and the Beacons a very good, well, exceptional free throw shooting team, but they haven't been able to knock down free throws in the late quarters when it matters.
Rivera leaves it for Edwards. Edwards through contact, offensive foul. Owls will come the other way. And a big call, if that's called defensive, that's four quick fouls on Keene State. And the Beacons are going back to the line. If it had been the defensive foul. Purcell tees up the three. Good. Lead back up to 14.
Purcell red hot from behind the arc.
They will stop the clock as the ball got away and rolled back to the little divider back there. And it actually gives the Beacons a chance to change and Chantel Jordan into the game.
Chantel Jordan with four fouls. Very pivotal. If she does get another foul, she would be fouled out of this game.
It'll be interesting to see if they have her guard, one of the primary ball handlers in Vital or Purcell, or if they try to keep her off the ball defensively. Spin move from Burston. Attacks with the left hand. Now maybe starting to take over a little bit. Taje Burston with 8 points. That's tied with a couple of players for the team high. Vital Burston up on her. Purcell, another three from the near side. No, caught the rim and away.
And another offensive rebound by the Owls.
Carey called on Vital. Beacons will get it back. Vital still, because that shot will not count. 2 of 10 from three. 2 of 10 from the field. And if you take her out, the Owls are nearly shooting 50%. Instead, they're at 32 right now. Edwards works her way in. She's fouled. She'll go to the line.
Yeah, I mean, when you're talking about three-point shooters that have really done a damage on the Beacons today, Purcell and McPadden. Obviously, McPadden only made two, but very crucial three-pointers, obviously, at the end of the third quarter, and Purcell two already in the fourth quarter.
Edwards, senior forward from Springfield, Massachusetts, has been efficient today in limited minutes. She can't get that one to go, but it's 3 of 4 from the field, now 2 of 4 from the stripe. She was bothered by what looks like a cramp earlier. They hope to have her down the stretch here. She's played well. Gets that one to go. Gives her a team high 9 points. Purcell gives it out to Benanzio. In the post. Back out. Benanzio tees up the three as the defense closes. No good. Chantel Jordan couldn't fight to come down for that rebound. She's got to watch the fouls. So it's another offensive rebound for the Owls. Vital's going to reset it with 23 on the shot clock. 6:22 remaining in regulation. Denolfo's floater not even close. Offensive rebound. No good. Taken away by the Beacons. It's Edwards coming the other way. Running with Jordan. Has her back door. Edwards going to take it herself. It's waved off. Now they'll count it late. Initially waved off by the official, but then the signal that the basket would count. That's Christine Sampson making the call.
And checking in, Katie Matthews, another Beacon with four fouls. So Coach Ball can see that right now they're getting something going, and they have to kind of score some points with only 6 minutes left.
Crucial sequence down 9. Edwards a chance to make it 8. Rims out, offensive rebound, Raven Kelsey, and she'll dribble back out. She may not have realized how much room she had to possibly go back up with that.
Yeah, it looked like she had an open lane to the basket, but obviously with Denolfo on her all night.
Burston's floater, no good. But the foul.
And the Beacons really attacking the basket right now. That's why they've had to go to the free throw line, especially with Raven Kelsey's offensive rebound that has led to this.
Make it 5 fouls on Keene State. That one's going to go on Vital, so she now has 3. Burston has hit both her free throws so far today. Front rims that one.
Oh, it looks like you jinxed it.
Broadcaster's jinx. It's a problem. When I did a baseball game on Cape Cod, I was voiced for a team over there a couple summers ago. Gets like the 5th inning, and we noticed the pitcher for the other team's throwing a no-hitter. My broadcast partner, who said we work for the team, so we should be loyal, at the top of his lungs in the booth keeps going, and he's still throwing a no-hitter. So I read an article next day in the paper. They interviewed the pitcher about it. A traveling violation on Keene State. Beacons will get it back. And they asked the pitcher, when did you realize you were about to throw a no-hitter? And he says, well, about the 6th inning, I kept hearing their broadcaster yelling.
So did he end up throwing the no-hitter?
He did end up throwing the no-hitter, actually. It was very cool. It was a cool moment to be a part of. And I believe he was, I'm trying to remember his name. He was a major league draft pick, middle-round draft pick last year. Overcame, he had a battle with cancer too. Really a great story. And I'm trying to remember his name as a big shot from Raven Kelsey.
Big shot for Raven Kelsey. And the tides turn for the Beacons with a turnover and then 2 points for Raven Kelsey. Timeout, Keene State Owls.
And we will take a timeout here back within 6. 5:07 to go in the quarter. Keep it here on the Beacon Broadcast Network.
The University of Massachusetts Boston, with its scenic oceanfront campus, easily accessible to downtown Boston, is recognized as a model of excellence for urban public universities. 16 NCAA Division III sports are part of the more than 100 student organizations that create an engaging campus life in America's biggest and best college town. UMass Boston, Boston's urban public research university for the 21st century.
Devin Smelter was the pitcher. He was drafted by the Dodgers, just so you guys all know.
When I was in JV baseball, I played baseball here at UMass Boston. Just a lesson for me, sitting on the bench. I was a pitcher, had a day off. Buddy of mine was throwing a no-hitter through 6.
Oh, you didn't tell him?
Didn't talk to him. I didn't tell him, but I looked over at my buddy. I was like, dude, you realize this guy's throwing a no-hitter right now.
Oh.
Next pitch, bleeder through the middle.
See, it's one thing first for broadcasters hit. To do it.
Yeah.
We're like universally hated.
Well, yeah.
You're supposed to be his teammate.
Well, you know, you live and you learn, I guess.
Inbounded to Denolfo. 5 minutes to go. Beacon's down six and on quite a run as they chip away. What was at one point a 15-point lead. Bursting up on Vitale, knocks it away. It's going to stay with the Owls. And Christina Baugh doing jumping jacks on the sideline. She thought her team had the ball.
And the reason why the Beacons are pulling in so close is because of the turnovers, because of the defense, and finishing when they're attacking the basket.
Needs to get it in. 5 second violation. Here come the Beacons. They can get it within four. 3-pointer makes it a one score game. 4:52 to go. You have to wonder at this point, is the Beacons' biggest opponent Keene State or is it the clock? Burst into her right. Comes back around. Drives in left hand. She's fouled. Gets it to go. Burston a chance to bring it within three.
Taje Burston being the playmaker that she needed to be in the second half. I mean, without Grace Geary, without Raven Kelsey really today, Burston having a game to remember with 9 points so far.
Can't get that one to fall, so it stays a four-point game with 4:37 to go. Owls coming up the other way quickly. They get it to the corner. Vitale hesitates and kicks it back to Denolfo. Denolfo guarded by Matthew with four fouls. She has to be careful how she plays this. Gets it to Vitale, guarded by Burston. To her right. Purcell drives. Loses the ball, but she was knocked. Looks like this is going to go against Edwards. Will not be a shooting foul. Beacons have a couple fouls to give. And the inbound will come underneath. That's the third foul on Edwards. They lob it into Denolfo. Denolfo fighting through. The defense can't get it to go. Great stuff by Matthew being aggressive with four fouls. Burston hesitates. Drives in. Kisses the glass. No, but she's fouled again.
And you can see Taje Burston not looking to pass right there like she usually does. Takes it to the rack. Takes initiative and goes to the line for two.
And Keith Boucher just got teed up. Is not happy. And if it's on personal, that's her fifth. So in that sequence, a technical, the leading scorer fouls out of the game, and the Beacons will have a chance to bring this within one.
And we talked about it, Boucher, a very renowned coach, obviously.
28 years.
28 years, a very good coach, a lot of accolades, a stupid mistake right there.
And the assistant coach is doing a good job of getting over to him, calling the players in so he has somebody to talk to here. Give him a chance to cool his head, although he does not look happy walking the sideliner now. He goes over to ask the table something, I think trying to figure out what the situation is with his star guard.
It looks like he's talking to the
Purcell.
Looks like he started complaining to the MC.
As Kessel rims that one out. Needed that one. Second one is good. And now Burston will get hers. Boucher back to his bench. And it's not uncommon for the coach to try to get clarification when a player fouls out from the scorer's table. First one, front rim, no again. So the Beacons crossing themselves here at the line, Steve.
And a key to the game, and we talked about it before, they have to make crucial free throws. And they haven't done it all year in the fourth quarter, and you're seeing that again today.
Gets that one to go. We have a two-point game with 4:05 to go. In this quarter, Keene State led by as many as 15. Open underneath, layup good. That was Petro. She killed him in the first half, has been quiet in the second half, but gets that to go. 56-52 the score.
Yeah, the Beacon's not having a lot of size on the floor right now. It'll be interesting to see if they keep going to Petro for those easy lay-ins.
Burston back to Chantel Jordan. Jordan to Matthew. Kelsey to her right, has to think about it, gives it back to Burston. Burston off balance, that time it's an offensive foul. And you're only going to get called for fouls so many times.
And Coach Boucher has to go behind the scores table. Maybe disagreeing or agreeing.
Maybe initially thought it was a defensive foul. And that was an offensive foul. That's the right call. But maybe initially thought the call was going the other way. And if so, he would have every right to be upset. DeNolfo trying to drain some clock now. Guarded by Matthew. Drives to her right. Underhanded layup. Bounces around and falls. Keene State quiet 4-0 run to get the lead back up to 6.
Yeah, DeNolfo such a dynamic player for Keene State.
Beacons have yet to lead in this game. Back to Matthew. She loses it. Ball coming to the sideline. Picked up. Vital handles. Thought about the three. Instead, pass it away as Keene State will drain the clock again. 2:42 now remaining with 22 on the shot clock. DeNolfo guarded by Kelsey. Now 10 on the shot clock. Trying to force her to her right. They do. Doubles back to her left. Kicks it out. Pull up from the free throw line is good. McPadden gets it back to 8. Beacons, remember, had it within 2 just moments ago.
And this happened UMass Dartmouth game. The Beacons had it. Tie game going into the...
Burston goes back to the spinning layup. It's been effective all game.
Going into the fourth quarter tie game. 6 minutes to go tie game. But then the train fell off the tracks, and you can see that. But Burston bring him within 6.
A tick under 2 to go. 6-point game. This time it's Matthew up on DeNolfo. Playing her straight on. DeNolfo hesitates to the elbow. Spins around, cuts in, lays it up, no good. Offensive rebound, Petro with the positioning. Tries to kick it out. And a 3-second violation on the Owls. Beacons get bailed out on the 17th offensive rebound of the game for the Owls. Now more offensive rebounds than defensive. Plus 10 on the offensive glass. We talked before the game about how crucial it would be for the Beacons to come away plus in the rebounding column. It's still close. It's still 5, but just killed offensively on the glass. Burston takes the 3 in front of the bench. Hits the glass. It doesn't go. 1:19 to go. Beacons need a turnover. And a timeout called quickly by Keith Boucher to avoid the 8-second violation. 1:17 on the clock. We'll keep it here. Steve, what needs to happen for the Beacons to at least force overtime?
Well, I mean, you got to have either a good basket quick or a 3-pointer to bring them within one possession. But obviously, they got to score somehow.
Just a reminder, stay tuned. The men's game, same schools, about 20 minutes after the conclusion of this one. So the 3 o'clock start time will presumably get pushed back a little bit. 2:45 right now. Keep it with us for postgame here as well. Break this one down. Talk to Christina Baugh as well. Beacons come out with Edwards, Kelsey, Matthew, Burston, and Jordan. The Owls are going to counter with Vitel, DeNolfo, Benanzio. I'm trying to find the two players I missed here. McPadden and Petro. Trying to get the ball in. 5-second violation.
And turnovers have been the story for both teams tonight. 25 for Keene State and 15 for the Beacons.
I don't remember the last time I saw a game with this many 5-second calls. Inbounding has been a problem. Burston around the key. Matthew kicks it in the corner. Jordan, it's a 3 if it's good. No. Rebound, Keene State. Matthew comes back to make the foul and a little slow to get up here. Now up to her feet. And that is her 5th. Here comes Maritza Scott. You can see in the background the UMass Boston men's team heading out to the floor. Denolfo gets it in. And there's the foul from Scott. Beacon's fouling early with 1:02 to go. This will be McPadden at the line.
McPadden, 54.5% from three throw. So you got to wonder if they found the person that they really wanted to go to the line.
First one is good. It's her first trip to the stripe today. The very least, doing a good job of forcing the inbound to a player who's not a good free throw shooter. That one's good. 8-point game, 1:02 to go. Beacons need to score. They need to score quickly. Get it into Burston. Up over half court. Dribbles to her right. Gets it back. Jordan thought about the deep three. Over-under move. Contested three. No good. Back rim. Rebound comes out. Keene State gets it off the bounce. Dribbling through is Vital. She is hacked. And that may do it.
And something to look at. Vital has really given Burston a lot of room all game to kind of take a shot. But she looks to pass it first.
Vital's 2-for-2 from the stripe. 80% on the year. And the first one hits bottom. 63-54. You told me before the game, Stephen, we were kind of talking about what we were looking for. The Beacons have had a problem in recent games of digging themselves into holes early that they can't get out of. And that seems to be the case here as Baugh takes the timeout. The Beacons played a very good second half, yeah, but just could not dig themselves out of the first half 15-point hole.
Yeah, and it looks like we saw the light at the end of the tunnel for the Beacons, obviously within 4 points after being down 15 this quarter. And they were so close, but unable to shoot free throws too well. I mean, obviously, on the day, the free throws percentage was 57.7, but they were more like 50% this quarter.
Beacons in the first half of games this year average 31 points per game. That goes up to 36 in the second half. And you have to wonder as well, no Grace Geary today definitely hurt them as they had trouble finding a shooter early before Burston really took over in the fourth quarter.
Yeah, she hasn't been there the last two games, and the field goal percentage was at 45%, which isn't too bad on the day, but they really didn't have that playmaker to kind of get a basket when they need to without kind of doing pick and rolls, passing it around, someone that could just drive to the basket and make a quick basket when they need it.
Jordan gets it into Burston.
Burston's had a great game with 14 points.
She's fouled, trying to get some room. And she'll go to the line at this point. Keene State probably takes that for possession, runs some time off the clock, and it's a two instead of a three. Burston's first shot is good. Be 42 seconds on the clock, 41.8 when we get going again.
Burston, who just averages about 6 points a game, 15 points in today's contest.
Beacon's trying to get the foul, and Burston will do it. That's her fourth. It's now a 9-point game with 38 to go. They send Vital back to the line. Hasn't missed in four tries. First one, no good. So she's now 4 of 5. Second one goes. We're back to a 10-point game, 65-55. Jordan, corner three, highly contested, grabs glass, and it's away. Trying to dribble through the contact, and there is the foul from Chantel Jordan.
And, I mean, what point do you kind of stop fouling? I mean, 25 seconds left, down 10 points. Reggie Miller is not on the team.
That's a good. That's a great reference right there.
What point do you really stop fouling?
Mike Padden, 2 of 2 from the stripe today. First one, back rim and no. I would think that would be the last one. Once you get into a double-digit game, then generally, as a rule of thumb, you don't foul. They did start fouling early, too, which is part of it. Normally you don't see a team foul with more than a minute left on the clock. But Keene State has not been great from the stripe this season. So it's worth a try, though. Excellent today going into that. I don't have the percentage with that last one. But 87% from the stripe for the Owls. They hit 21 free throws, which, I mean, the turnovers aside, that in itself is killer when a team's converting that much from the line.
And, I mean, another point, we've said it all night, it's kind of drilled into my mind right now, offensive rebounds for Keene State, 18 offensive rebounds and 7 offensive rebounds for the Beacons.
Stay with us post-game. We'll talk to Christina Baugh. Have the Steve and I's reactions from this one as well as a look ahead
and when you
to
talk
the men's
about,
game.
And when you talk about points in the paint, the Beacons have 30 points in the paint to Keene State's 20. So majority of the Beacons game was kind of played in the paint and on the free throw line today.
Offensive foul, and Beacons will come up and press here with 25.2 on the clock, an 11-point game. They get it in. Now just trying to trap. Keene State over half court. And looks like they will just try to dribble this out. Vitale with it. Bursting up on her with 10 to go. And that will do it. One last dribble from McPadden. And the clock runs out before the ball went out of bounds. So, Keene State kicks a two-game losing streak. They improve to 12-7 on the year and 6-3 in the conference, not to mention 6-1 on the road. Meanwhile, the Beacons will fall to 8-11, 4-5 in conference, and are now on a two-game losing streak. We're going to step aside. We'll be back real quick with Christina Baugh, and then Steve and I break it down, keep it here on the Beacon Broadcast Network.
Hi, my name is Carl Joseph. I'm currently a criminal justice major. I'm a senior. I am from Brockton, Massachusetts. In basketball, I play small forward / power forward, and in track, I'm a high jumper. Basketball has always been my first love. The favorite part was probably our win over MIT. Like that was tremendous. I almost came to tears just from where the program has come from where I first came here to where we are now. It's just amazing, and I love it. Honestly, I was recruited for basketball. My high school coach actually emailed the track coach here, and she walked into the gym one day, and it was just like, here, you, come talk to me. And I was on the track team. It really wasn't much of a choice. It was a great honor my freshman year, just being able to become an All-American, finishing fourth in my first ever national championship meet. It was quite the time of my life. My junior year, we received our LEC championship rings from our sophomore year. And coming in to my freshman year at UMass, I was able to witness the volleyball team win their championship and the soccer team, and the only thing that I really wanted was a ring of my own.
Here's Joseph knifing through.
Funny thing is, I actually work here as well. I am one of the Zamboni drivers to our men's and women's hockey teams, and that's what I do for part-time. Being a student here at campus, I can honestly tell you, is quite different from anywhere else you could possibly go. Just the student body here is amazing. I mean, the teachers are amazing. All the teachers that I've had never hesitated to help me out in any way that they could have, from extra help to me going into their offices just to talk about what's going on in the classes and to keep me on track. What I want to do when I graduate, I want to go into the police force for a little bit and ultimately end up either working for the Department of Homeland Security or the Department of ICE. It's definitely possible to be a two-sport athlete here at UMass Boston. It's just going to take a little bit of hard work.
Now joined by head coach Christina Ball. And coach, you guys started to put that run together there in the fourth. You got it within two. What stopped you guys from getting over the hump?
Some defensive lapses. And one-on-one defense.
What happened on the glass that they were able to dominate you offensively?
We didn't box out. You know, it's a game of fundamentals, and there's some things you got to do in order to be successful, and that's rebound and defend. And we didn't do that for 40 minutes today.
What's a message you can take out of a game like this to pass on to the team, a positive message?
We played a full second half. You know, if you look at the second half, we win by one. So being ready at the start of the game is huge. And we got to find a way out of the lull because it's going to happen in every game. So whether that's sharing the ball or making a foul shot, we got to find a way to handle that.
Thank you very much, Coach. And good luck next time. Keep it here. Steve and I will break down this the game right after this. And we're back here at the Clark Athletic Center. Alex Barth, Steve Witkowski, and Steve, as we take a look at the final stats in this one, again, Keene State with the win, 66-55. It all goes back to the rebounding.
Yeah, it all goes back to the rebounding. Obviously, not the day the Beacons really wanted to have on the boards, and not the day they really wanted to have in the game. You heard Christina Ball talk about it. They need to come back out and play harder right off the bat, and really get into a rhythm right off the bat, and they didn't do that today.
18 offensive rebounds for the Owls. Shockingly, not that far over their average, 16 a game, 16 and a half a game. But, again, you're not going to win when the rebounding margin is that difficult. Meanwhile, only 7 offensive rebounds for a pretty good offensive rebounding team in the Beacons.
And the Beacons, I mean, most of the time, Illabody wasn't out there. Katrina Edwards wasn't really out there with limited minutes. So you had more of a smaller lineup for the Beacons, and it didn't help at all on the boards.
The individual leaders, a game-high 15 points for Taje Burston, and she really got it going in the fourth quarter. 5 of 9 from the field, was also 5 of 9 from the stripe. Stephanie DeNolfo had a team-high 14 for Keene State as a part of a 14-11 double-double. 9 defensive rebounds, 2 offensive rebounds. Amanda Petro out-rebounded the Beacons on the offensive glass alone. 10 rebounds, 8 of them offensive. She also had 6 points on 3 of 7 shooting. 5 assists for DeNolfo. Nobody else had more than 2. So that's a stat line of 14, 11, and 5 as you see the leaders right there. And 4 steals and for Vital. And she was pesky all night.
And we talked about it before the game. We got to slow. The Beacons really have to slow down DeNolfo. You could see her presence on defense. when she was guarding Raven Kelsey. You could see her presence on offense, obviously, with the points. She's all over that leaderboard. And a great game by Denolfo, a great game by Keene State.
So what is ahead, you ask? Keene State will play an out-of-conference game this week. They will be at Middlebury before returning to conference play. They will be at Southern Maine February 4th. Meanwhile, the Beacons will play Bowdoin in their final non-conference game during the week. And then they will visit Rhode Island College to finish up that season series on the 4th before taking on U of Southern Maine in their next home game February 8th. You can get your coverage of that on the Beacon Broadcast Network. Each team with just a few games to go, conference tournament coming up at the end of February. Steve, your final thoughts?
Final thoughts, I mean, it's upsetting for a Beacons fan to see their team play like this. I mean, with the absence of Grace Geary, you could definitely see that on your offense. And with Grace Geary out, you could see Taje Burston really taking the boatload of the scoring, which is exciting to see.
Before we sign off, two quick things. First off, a reminder, for updates on all things Beacons Athletics, you can find us online, beaconsathletics.com, facebook.com/UMassBeacons, at UMass Beacons on Twitter, also on YouTube and Instagram, same handles as the kids like to say. And a couple of people we need to thank, because you heard me and Steve yapping all afternoon, but it wasn't just us, to our producer, Seth Orensky, to our directors, Rachel Maslach and Gigi Braga, instant replay, Matt Coakley, Steve was next to me, our camera operators, Carly Robinson, Emily Steinberg, and Alyssa Fugel. I am Alex Barth. Thanks for watching. We'll be back in about 15 minutes with the opening tip between the Beacons and the Keene State men's game. Thanks for watching this presentation of the Beacon Broadcast Network. Did gas tank here. Steve, how you doing?
Great. I mean, second game today. Refueling, recharging, and it should be a good one today.
Getting ready to go. In this game, you have two teams on opposite sides of the spectrum heading in different directions, looking to reverse it. Keene State is 13-5 this year, but 3-5 on the road. 6-2 in conference play, including three wins in a row. On the other side, you have UMass Boston. They started off hot, but are now 10-8, 3-5 in conference. They have lost their last four. Both these teams right in the middle of things in the conference. Keene State in second place. UMass Boston is currently tied for fifth with three teams. So, Steve, a win today for the Beacons would go a long way, whereas if Keene State wins, they're going to get a lot of momentum going into the conference tournament at the end of the season.
Yeah, I mean, obviously a scuffling UMass Boston team, they got to get back on the horse. They were last time they faced Keene State, they were at the top of the division, coming off a huge regionally ranked Tufts win. So it's a totally different game. The Beacons are at a totally different point in this season, so it should be interesting to see how they face adversity and come out today.
What's been different these last four games for the Beacons that they're on this four-game slide?
Well, they haven't really closed out games. I mean, they've had opportunities. They've only lost by a couple points, but it's just crucial free throw shooting at the end of the game that they haven't really risen to the occasion and knocked them down.
Today's player to watch, a junior from Boston, Massachusetts, from Charlestown High School, is Kadeem Kirksey. Kirksey appearing in his 81st career game with the Beacons, and he has been a big part of this team so far this year.
81st career game, but 18th.
Oh, sorry about
Boston.
That. Yep.
I just want to clarify that. A transfer from Massachusetts College of Liberal Arts in Western Mass, my neck of the woods. A great guy, a great player, and a leader for this UMass.
See, the 81 team and the 18, they're backwards there, Kirksey, this year. 8.5 points per game. He has been one of the Beacons' most effective players off the bench, to the point where he has found himself with the third most minutes per game of anybody on this team. Taking a look at the all-time series here real quick, and we'll point out specifically the last matchup, a 90-80 win up in New Hampshire earlier this year for the Owls. But in that game, Dan Powers went off with the double-double. 17 points, 10 rebounds. Sam Freeman, 15 points as well. Ty Lee almost had a double-double with 10 points and 7 boards. On the other side, you got to look.
And Keene State, a very athletic and a very tall team to really play against. Kind of the opposite, which the Beacons really like to play.
In that last meeting, Jaquel Edwards had 24 points, a great game. Nichols added 18 points, 9 assists, and 5 rebounds. So a couple guys to keep an eye on here this afternoon. Taking a look at the starting lineups first off for the visiting Keene State Owls. Ty Nichols up there at the guard position. He's the team's leading scorer. He leads the team in points per game, assists per game, steals in minutes. Matt Ozella, it's a big body down low, 6'4". He'll come out and play the wing sometimes as well, the second leading scorer for the Owls. Meanwhile, for the Beacons, their starting lineup pretty much as it's been. Icer Barnes, Ty Lee, Dan Powers, Sam Freeman, Kareem Kirksey. The head coach of the Beacons is Jason Harris, and he told me last time, when Sam eats, we all eat, so you got to keep an eye on big number 30 in the middle, as always. Yep. Meanwhile, on the other side for Keene State, behind their benches, second-year man Ryan Kane, a 33-16 career record, a graduate of Worcester Polytechnic Institute. Again, your neck of the woods. He is a it is his second year as a coach. He has posted a 33-16 record. The keys to the game, Steve.
The keys to the game, I mean, you mentioned it. Sam has to be a big deal in this game. You have to attack the post, make Keene State College really go big, and have to be better in transition. They did a good job in the beginning of the season, kind of slack late, and they have to get out to a hot start.
And you can use Sam Freeman to attack the post as he's in there for the jump, and he wins it forward to Icer Barnes.
So if the Beacons are really going to win this game, they have to play quick and explosive, and you can see them really getting off to a quick start so far.
Freeman, the up and under is good, and the foul. Quick start for Sam Freeman. The Beacons wearing their home whites with blue trim. They will move left to right across your screen. The Keene State Owls in the red jerseys with the KSC on the front, Keene State College, they will move right to left.
And Keene State coming off a huge win at Eastern Connecticut State. So it'd be interesting to see if they kind of are a little lackadaisical coming off that huge win, beating number 1 Eastern Connecticut State in the LEC.
Freeman, 3 quick points. This is Ty Nichols. Nichols drives in, looking for something with the left hand. Swung around the perimeter. Little bit of confusion. Now it's Hamill with it. Lucas Hamill gets a pick to his right. Drives in on Freeman, kicks it to the corner. Driving in is Nichols, draws the double ball, knocked away, and stolen by Icer Barnes.
And Icer Barnes is a great Beacon that can really run the floor very quick, and obviously is going to be a huge part in that transition point for the Beacons.
Now it's Ty Lee. Lee screen to his right, looking inside for Freeman, then gives it to Powers. Powers three is good. 6-0 Beacons early.
And Powers is one of those players that can play down low, but he also has a great three-point shot, which is he's probably going to utilize today.
Pull-up jumper in the lane is good. No issues for Jaquel Edwards. Wearing number 35, and he kind of has that Kevin Durant build. He's got those long arms. Slender frame, can move quickly. Be an alley-oop, maybe?
I mean, I don't know. It was a little hard for an alley-oop, to say the least.
Ty Lee back to Barnes. Barnes to the corner. Kirksey, this time he hesitates. Loses the ball going to the lane. It's stolen by the Owls, who throw it right away. Kept in bounds. And after a little bit of scary back and forth for both teams, the men in red will come the other way. This is Nichols. He's got that. It looks like he has the St. Louis Rams helmet permanently on his head as the jumper falls from Lucas Hamill.
Yeah, you can see that. He's a very versatile player. Obviously can score the basketball, but also is very good with assists.
Powers in the post, guarded by Edwards, back to him, leaves it for Barnes. Barnes to Kirksey, up to Powers, ball hard on the floor, inside to Freeman. It was waved off.
You can see the Beacons are really trying to get the ball inside to Freeman, being guarded by number 34, Jeff Lund. Lund has a couple inches on Freeman at 6'6", where Freeman stands at 6'4".
Inside to Powers, touch and go layup, no good, but he pokes the rebound away. Thought about the corner three. Instead, he gives it back to Ty Lee, and the Beacons reset Nobody plays more minutes per game on this team than Ty Lee does. He's only played in 13 of those games, but when he does, he plays more than 75% of the contest. Baseline jumper, Kirksey. Nobody near him knocks it down. Hamill tries to drive. They're going to say he was pushed out of bounds. Foul will go on Iser Barnes. And we have a timeout on the floor. We're going to step aside. 15:52 to go in the first half. Beacons 8, Keene State Owls 6. Keep right here on the Beacon Broadcast Network.
Psychology is about understanding the individual and understanding the mind. The main reason why I want to combine psychology and business degrees is because I want to understand the business decisions that are made. I'm Nurcan Çelebi. I'm from Turkey originally. I'm a senior at the 5-year BA to MBA program at UMass Boston. I think in management, the biggest mistake you can make is to not listen. So I want to be able to step into a company and say, here's what you're doing now, and here's how you can improve it. I moved here when I was 16 for high school. Moving from Turkey, it was a rough journey for me because when you don't really speak the language that well, and when you don't really fit in the crowd, it's very easy to disappear. But I decided not to give up, so, and UMass helped me. I wanted to be able to improve myself. I wanted to be able to try new things.
Back is Keene State misses a shot. Live on the Beacon Broadcast Network, UMass Boston against the Keene State Owls. Powers throws near side to Ty Lee. Lee back to Powers. Drives the lane, try to get it to Freeman. It's knocked wide. Nice catch by the ref. And the Beacons will keep it.
A lot of we saw it in the first game. Keene State player threw it about 30 feet over a player. Again today by a Keene State player. And then Dan Powers hucks it over a player's head again.
Kirksey trying to get inside of Freeman. Instead gets it to Barnes, cutting in the back door. No, that's Lee. Leaves it for Powers. Powers misses his second layup of the game. And after knocking down a three early, he's struggled a bit from the field. Ty Nichols recovers after having the ball knocked away. This is Hamill. Lucas Hamill looking for something inside. Gets it to Edwards. Edwards, fadeaway turnaround. Good.
And you compared him to a Durant-like player earlier. A very smooth shot. And that's 4 points for Edwards.
Lee steps back near the coach's line. Guarded by Hamill. Freeman trying to set the pick. Now steps off of it. Trying to keep Lee on the right side of the court. Now he breaks to his left. Leaves it for Barnes. Barnes, spin move. Back to Lee. Fires it inside. Freeman. Through contact. No. Rebound. Kirksey goes up to get it. Hangs in. Hits.
Acrobatic lay-in for Kareem Kirksey. Player to watch today.
And an offensive foul the other way. So quick 4 points for Kirksey. He makes the nice play on defense. And the Beacons with a 2-point lead, 14:33 to go here in the first half. Matt Ozella checks into the game for the Owls. Lead of Freeman. Pull up, Barnes for two.
Iser Barnes, a great shooter and a great playmaker for the Beacons. Makes a lot of stuff happen on the court.
Keene State trying to push the tempo. Nichols drives. You can see the height advantage Nichols has on the Beacons guards. Tipped back in by Nichols. And that is a place where Keene State really can take advantage. You got the 6'3 Ty Nichols, who's a forward but plays like a point guard, being guarded by Ty Lee and Iser Barnes at 5'10 and 5'9 respectively.
Yeah, they got a lot of height, especially on the Beacons, which is a very small lineup in the LEC.
Kirksey, no. Coming down with the rebound is Edwards. 6'3 using that reach. Driving in, leaner, nope. And Freeman bounces it to Powers for the board.
The refs letting the players play today. Looked like a little physical contact by Kareem Kirksey, no call.
Today's officials are Tiger Womack, Daniel Britt, and Leon Graves. corner three. Powers, no, follows his shot, has the rebound, misses another layup. That's his third. He's got himself in position for good shots. If he can start getting those to fall, Beacons are going to open one up here. Instead, it's a tie game as Nichols gets another one to fall. He's got 4 points. And we have a timeout on the floor. For substitutions, Jake Colligan comes in, a freshman from Westerfield, Connecticut.
And Alex Sanchez has not checked into this game yet. Oh,
and now heads over to the table. There you go.
How about that? On good
insight. And he is joined by Neil Cesar. Beacons getting ready to change the guards out as Kirksey glides in. Thought for a second he might try to dunk that one. I think I saw him dunk in warm-ups.
Might have been Sam Freeman. Both corn rolls. Similar face structure.
Kirksey has the ups, though. He definitely got to level where he could dunk it, but wants the sure points here at this point in the game. Ozella corner three, no good. Going up, Iser Barnes skying to get that rebound over the much taller Edwards. And now coming back the other way, it's Ty Lee in the foul.
And you could see the intensity on the Beacons' faces after a basket earlier by Sam Freeman and now a basket by Ty Lee. They really need this game, especially in conference, where they sit 3-5, where they were once 3-2 a couple weeks ago.
And the four-game losing streak really coming to a culmination last time out against UMass Dartmouth. Beacons falling 101-74. Powers and Freeman 17-16 in that one respectively, so they played well, but unable to get done on the defensive end. Kirksey throws one up off the glass, and he's fouled.
Well, I was here for that game, and at the end of the game, Sam Freeman missed two crucial three throws. Obviously, had great stats up until then. Obviously, their guy just front-rimmed one and missed another.
Kirksey to the line for the first time. Already has 6 points. And that is a game high.
That's the thing with this Beacons team is they are much smaller when you look at Alex Sanchez, Ty Lee, Iser Barnes, and Kareem Kirksey. But they do have a lot of hops.
A team that will jump out of the gym. For sure, Kirksey misses the first one. Second one is good, a 71% free throw shooter. Gets one of two, Beacon 17, Owls 12. 12-18 to go here in the first as Keene State brings the ball up. Dayson Sinelli now into the game playing defense. He's on the cover of today's game day program. That's going to be a travel. Sinelli forces the issue.
Sinelli, a taller freshman, a good build, especially for this Beacon team that lacks size.
Sinelli, 6'1", 165, a freshman from the Boston Collegiate Charter School. Powers on the elbow, needs to get rid of it. Gets it over to the corner. That's Cesar. His three is no good. Sinelli almost pulled that one down. Jumped a little too early. Hamill comes down with it. And then he is fouled by Kirksey trying to get it going.
Yeah, you can see another player for the Beacons that really does have hops is Dayson Sinelli.
11:53 to go in the first half. Timeout on the floor. We will step aside. Beacon 17, Owls 12 on the Beacon Broadcast Network.
What do we mean when we say UMass is here for a reason? We mean that the five-campus UMass system is the only public research university that the people of Massachusetts established to create better futures for themselves, but also for the Commonwealth of Massachusetts as a whole. It's a university that educates 73,000 students every day and graduates 17,000 graduates every year. We are the university that educates the workforce of Massachusetts. We're one of the state's three major academic research engines. Research that saves and improves people's lives, and research that drives the innovation economy of Massachusetts. We provide services and economic opportunity to every region of the Commonwealth. The noted historian David McCullough once said that two great concepts, university and Massachusetts, come together in only one place, and we are very aware of how fortunate we are to bear the name University of Massachusetts. We recognize that we are truly here for a reason, and that recognition inspires us and drives.
Back here at the Clark Athletic Center. Out of the timeout, it's the Owls, and underneath Jeff Lund lays it up. for two. 17-14 now your score. This is Alex Sanchez now in the game. Sanchez gets a pick, moving to his right, gives it to the corner. Sinelli up to Powers. Powers going to drive, takes on five, kicks it off for Kirksey. Hangs, doesn't hit, tapped out. It will stay Beacon ball. Sinelli will inbound. Gets it into Kirksey, back to Powers. Underneath, nice pocket pass. Can't get it to go. Defense was there. And a jump ball. Possession Beacons.
And Sam Freeman checking back into this game. Sits at 3 points only today. It would be interesting to see if he becomes more of an asset to this offense.
They get into Kirksey. Defender overjumped it inside. Sinelli overhand off the glass for two. 19-14 Beacons. 11:05 to go. Lund's going to take the mid-range jumper and hit it. The big man, 6'6".
Alex Sanchez on the floor. Ty Lee just checked out. Sanchez usually runs this point.
Kirksey to his right, back to Sinelli. Fakes right, goes left, tries to throw it away. Out of bounds, it hit the official. Beacons will keep it with 12 seconds on the shot clock. Ty Nichols checks back into the game. Sanchez gets picked to his right, loses the ball, gets it back. Four on the shot clock, got to do something quick. They turn it over. Lucas Hamill hurrying back the other way. Hamill into the lane, through contact, no call. Officials letting him play. And Freeman eventually chases down the rebound. Kirksey the other way, offensive foul. Kirksey pleading his case, but it looked to be the right call. And halfway through half number one here, it's the Beacons up by three.
Yeah, it's always a tough situation, especially driving the lane. You really want to get that lay-in. But once he kind of assumes the position, you really have nowhere to go except for to foul.
Inbounded to Hamill.
It looked like he might have been pleading that he was in the circle too close to the basket.
One underneath. That shot is blocked. Ozella tried to go up with it. And a jump ball called there as Freeman got his hand on another one. Contesting Jimmy Lehman trying to get the shot to go up. Lehman's brother Jake, forward for the Portland Trail Blazers, played his college ball in Maryland. Both attended King Philip High School in Wrentham. And Lehman quickly back out of the game. The underneath, no good. Lunch shot is blocked, but he was fouled on the way up.
Sam Freeman questioning the call. It looked like he had good defense. Just a little too much contact down low.
Jeff Lund has played well in limited action, has played in just 8 of the Owls' 18 games, but he averages 7 points and 3 rebounds in those games. Also a great free throw shooter, 86% from the line, and he knocks down his first. That brings the Owls within 3, 9:49 to go. Beacons have led wire to wire, their largest lead being 6, but now it's down to just 1. Dan Powers will replace Neil Cesar. They get it to Powers to beat the trap. Powers up ahead to Sinelli. Has Freeman underneath. He's going to take it himself. No good. Jason Harris shaking his head. I think you want the backdoor pass to Freeman there for the easy layup.
Yeah, Freeman was wide open down low.
Nichols inside, Lund, turnaround hook shot, no. Powers rebound. Harris steps out to tell them to slow it down. Lee back to Powers in the corner. Barnes, three, got hit, no call, no good. Freeman tried to keep it in, but it's going the other way.
Interesting move by Harris to kind of tell him to slow down the pace just because the Beacons' pace usually is to kind of speed up the pace and kind of get transition points.
Nichols walks it up over half court. Guarded by Lee.
You can see he's trying to force him over to the left side. He doesn't want him to kind of attack that right side.
Taking advantage of the mismatch, Jaquel Edwards was guarded by Iser Barnes, but he can't hit the shot. Lee sees the lane, tried to drive it, closed off quickly. Circles back around with 20 on the shot clock, 8:41 to go in the half. Guarded by Ozella, Lee gets a pick to his right, hesitates, kicks it back to Barnes, now Powers, puts down the right shoulder, drives in, the floater, front rim, finally gets it to go after Dan Powers had missed a couple layups, was one of five from the field following an early three, gets that floater to finish, and it's 21-18 Beacons. Now Powers defensively, kicked out, DeMonte Turner, swung around, here's Nichols, Nichols to his right, pull up just inside the arc, good.
Yeah, such a great offensive player, can really drive the lane and also has a great outside shot.
Lee with 21 seconds to Barnes. Powers over to Lee. Try to get inside of Freeman, it's knocked away, he recovers. Back to Lee, Beacons reset, 5 seconds on the shot clock. Looks like Lee's going to take this himself. Kicks it back. Quick three from Barnes. He got it off. No good. Rebound Owls coming the other way. Edwards up ahead, but the Beacons take it away in transition. Lee tries to lob it inside to Barnes. Pass to no one. Ozella picks it off. He'll take it up himself. 7:20 to go in the half. Sanchez getting ready to come back in. Inside, Edwards has it stripped.
Back to back to back turnovers for both teams. Really stagnating the offense right now.
Barnes with the steal. He leads the team with just under two a game. And a foul on the floor.
And Powers a very good free throw shooter at 71%.
And he will take those free throws when we come back. It's Beacons up one, 21-20 with 6:58 to go here in the first half. You're watching the Beacons and the Owls on the Beacon Broadcast Network.
We graduate 17,000 students every year, and the vast majority of them stay in Massachusetts. We have over 280,000 graduates in Massachusetts today. We graduate people in critical fields, engineering, STEM fields. We graduate people with research experience where they can start their own companies. It is amazing to see what UMass graduates accomplish once they leave the university. I remember vividly my own graduation from UMass. It was a beautiful day. It was perfect weather. I remember the pride that my mother and father felt. I could see it in their eyes. Here it is, 30 years later, I get an opportunity to preside over UMass commencement. It is so moving and inspiring for me to think this is what it's for. Here we are, we have these graduates that we're going to unleash on the world, ready to take on the world, happy about the accomplishment, but also hopeful about the future. It's hard not to get emotional at a UMass graduation. You see that UMass is here for the Commonwealth, here for a reason.
My name is Allie Greenberg. I'm an ice hockey player here. I'm a junior.
Back here at the Clark Athletic Center. Alex Barth, Steve Witkowski. Dan Powers going to the line for two.
Or
this is the first one.
Or is it three? Because he was behind the three-point line.
I believe it is three. It is. Misses the second. He'll have one more, and you can see the frustration. Powers is at a rough start, 2-for-6 from the field. Missed a couple layups. Knocks that one down, so he salvages it with one, 22-20. Powers has gotten himself in position to score. This one's loose on the floor. Barnes has it. Needs to get rid of it. He's tied up, jump ball.
It looks as if he was trying to call a timeout there to kind of get the possession of the ball.
Beacons will keep it. I got to say, Powers has done a good job getting himself in position to score.
Yeah.
And if he can get these to fall, it will do wonders for the Beacons. Can't start hanging his head because he's played a good game. Ball just hasn't found the basket. This one's stolen, trying to get it to Powers. Up ahead, Ty Nichols, he throws it down. Sanchez works himself into the trap. And it's out of bounds off the Beacons.
And both Beacons kind of struggling, both Beacon point guards kind of struggling as of late. Ty Lee, you saw he got taken out of the game after a couple turnovers. Alex Sanchez getting taken out of the game right now after a couple turnovers. This is the second time these two teams are playing, so both guys have played this team before, so they know what usually is their plan to do.
Long two from Lund, no good. Sinelli has the rebound. He's on the break. Lays it up. No, but he draws the foul. Dayson Sinelli going to the line.
Sinelli, a very athletic Beacon, can really drive the floor and really run in transition very well.
Again, off the back rim, Beacon's putting a little too much on these free throws. Got to wonder if they're a little too fired up. They came out here running on all cylinders. They jumped out to a 6-0 lead, but we are tied at 22.
Yeah, only shooting 42.6% so far today, which is not usually like the usual Beacons team.
Sinelli gets the second one to go, but it's a one-point game, and Keene State with a chance to take their first lead of the game here with 6:05 remaining in the first half. Near side to Nichols. Pull up three off the dribble. It was halfway down. Could have popped out.
You could see Lee. Sam Freeman.
Yeah, he wants the ball. In the corner, Barnes. Oh, nice up fake. Back to Powers. Whistle blew first, traveling violation. Yeah, Freeman, open underneath. He wanted that ball.
Open underneath, working hard down low to kind of get some space and get some get the ball, obviously, down low, but hasn't been able to find him yet.
Inbounded to Lucas Hamill.
Freeman, only 3 points in this game. We talked about it. Dan Powers was the guy to go to last game at Keene State.
To the wing, nifty spin move, gets it to go.
And today so far, Kareem Kirksey leading all scores with 7 points, but not on the floor right now.
Lead of the wing, Sinelli. Kirksey now heading back over to the table. It's the second time you've called one of those.
Yeah, well, I'm on cue today.
Foul is going to be on Keene State on the floor. That's their seventh. And the next one will bring a 1-1 for UMass Boston. Here comes Kirksey. He'll grab Dayson Sinelli.
A 1-1 for UMass Boston, but they've been struggling as of late at the free throw line.
There it is, the 1-1 now. Pardon me, as Freeman heads to the stripe, 73% on the year. First one is good. And now the Beacons tie it back up after Keene State had taken their first lead of the game.
An interesting move to go with Red Sox against a Keene State red team.
He's getting ready. Spring training's in like 60 days.
Is that a fashion statement?
For, I don't know. New Mission High School? I don't know. Is their color red? Maybe Lucky High School socks? Well. Throwing back out and a travel. He's cutting to the basket. Dizelle Wright gets caught. Maybe it's just laundry day for Freeman.
Laundry day and game day on the same day, huh?
Put the clothes in the washer, come here for the game, warm up, go back, put them in the dryer, game starts.
And you got laundry by the end of the game.
That's how I used to do it in college. Granted, we were playing 2K, not actual basketball. As they foul underneath, and the Owls will get to the line. Been to the stripe just twice today. They're 2 for 2. This will be Dizelle Wright, sub-50 shooter from the stripe on the season. Junior from Putnam High School, Springfield, Massachusetts. No good.
Yeah, more of a, I mean, he took a three-pointer earlier this game and absolutely no legs into the shot. It looked like he used all arms. You could kind of see it on his free throw right here as well.
Yeah, it's kind of goes up on his toes.
No bend of the knees.
They get it into Kirksey. Got to hurry up, move this ball. Powers charging ahead, and they're over half court.
Great ball fake by Powers right there to get him to jump.
Lee reverses it to Barnes. Lee with 7 on the shot clock underneath. Barnes against the bigger man. Hook shot falls. He really had to contort himself to get that one to go.
Yeah, and you see that so often. I mean, Iser Barnes, a smaller guy, but can really get the lay-in acrobatically at any time over a larger individual.
Listed at 5'9", one of the shorter players on this roster, along with Alex Sanchez, listed at 5'5". Three-pointer, no good. That was Lehman.
And Kirksey's been quiet after a hot start for the Beacons.
Here's Kirksey, three-pointer. No good, maybe cooled off when he went to the bench. 3:32 to go in the half, 27-25 Beacons lead. Leaning layup falls around Freeman. Barnes hands it to Lee. Kirksey. Ball fake, drives over another man. Offensive foul.
And that's the second time today that Kirksey has gotten called on that foul.
That's his third of the game. My guess is he will sit. We will find out on the other side. 3:03 to go in the half. All not at 27. Keep it here. You're watching the Beacon Broadcast Network.
Jake. As usual, she wins it. A chance in front. Her shot is into net. Crystal
elated.
Yet another goal.
Please make a gift to the Beacon Athletic Fund today. We want you on our team.
.303 remaining in the first half here in Boston. Beacons and Owls knotted up. Alex Barth, Steve Witkowski. And right before the break, Kadeem Kirksey picked up an offensive foul, his third foul of the game, and he goes back to the bench. They haven't been able to get him on the floor. He has a team-high 7 points. But with the foul trouble, it's been tough justifying keeping him out there in what is now a tie game, 27-27, under 3 to go.
And like we said, two of those fouls coming on the offensive end.
Nichols, wild pass out beyond the arc, three-pointer. No good, rebound Ty Lee. Lee sprinting back the other way. The over-under is blocked, and the Beacons will keep it.
And that's something that Beacons have really been doing at the beginning of the year, is getting very good transition points, running the floor after a defensive play or a miss by the other team and really getting points off of that. Lately, they really haven't been able to execute that as well.
Lee Lee to Kirksey, back to Lee, outside Powers into the corner, quick passing now, back to Powers, takes on three, oh, got it to go, and he got whacked.
Dan Powers, a powerful player for the Beacons.
I see what you did there.
Dan Powers, a powerful play for the Beacons. Can really finish, even though he gets hacked.
And nice to see him not be discouraged. 2 for 6 from the field to this point. A lot of guys wouldn't take that shot. Even if they're hot, he was ice cold. And still got that to go. Over about 4 defenders, took the contact and all. That first free throw didn't count because one shot, they didn't get the sub in time. This is the real one. So it went better in practice than it did in reality. Power's not happy. Don't blame him. 2:18 to go in the half. Beacons up 29-27. Here's Edwards. Gets it back to Nichols. Inside, just out of the reach. Able to recover his right. Dizelle Wright fires inside. All alone underneath is Jimmy Lehman. And he turns around and puts it in.
Yeah, that's the second time today that the Beacons have really let that happen. Just a wide open lay-in. Coach Harris not happy about that.
Under 2 to go, 29 all. Lee calls the play. Freeman sets a screen off the ball for Alex Sanchez. Gets it back to Lee. Near side underneath, Cesar through the contact, no good. Can't get the rebound. Didn't even put it off the glass. Hit off this padding on the side of the backboard. But he comes back. Oh, it looks like he made the steal. He'll get called for a foul. Jason Harris is not happy. It looked like Sanchez clean picked his pocket, but instead it's going to be a one-and-one opportunity for the Owls.
And Sanchez is very good at doing that. Very good defensive player. Obviously a little smaller, can kind of get under their hands and take that ball from them, and a very good ball handler as well.
Keep it with us at halftime. We'll talk to Jason Harris. And Steve and I will break down the first half as well here on the Beacon Broadcast Network. Ty Nichols, second one falls. Across, nice pass, and Powers commits the foul. Had to do it. Keene State a chance to extend a 2-point lead. Nichols to the line.
And Keene State, a very good free throw shooter, especially today at 84%.
First one goes. Talked about Sam Freeman's socks. You look around Keene State, most of the players are wearing black shoes or red shoes. Ty Nichols' shoes are straight white. There isn't anything else on there.
Yeah, a little fashion statement.
Second one goes, 33-29. Keene State continues to press. Sanchez needs to get rid of it. Gets it up to Lee, 20 on the shot clock. Over to Barnes. Back to Lee, 15 on the clock. Back to Barnes. 10 seconds. Beacons need to do something with it. Powers, 6 seconds. Open three. Got it!
Ty Lee. Tyler, a good shooter, doesn't shoot much. Great look right there, and a great basket for the Beacons.
Brings the Beacons back within one, and then a turnover. Freeman quickly to Lee. Lee gives it over all alone. Iser Barnes gives the Beacons back the lead, 34-33. Keene State works quickly. They'll have a 2-for-1. If not, the Beacons will have the last possession. 30 on the game clock, 19 on the shot clock. Near side to Lehman. Edwards around, swings it back. Lehman's going to take the deep three, bricked it, nowhere close. 13 seconds, Beacons trying to extend the lead before halftime. And they will call a timeout, 9.4 on the clock. We'll keep it here. Steve, who should get the shot for UMass Boston?
Well, I think you got to work something. Obviously, to either Sam Freeman or even Dan Powers having a good hand right now.
Again, 9.4 with that three-pointer. Ty Lee up to 5 points. Dan Powers has a team high 8. Ty Nichols a game high 12. Each team's turned the ball over quite a bit. 11 for the Beacons, 10 for the Owls, but it's the Owls that have capitalized. 13 points off turnovers for them, just 8 for the Beacons. On the glass, the Beacons are dominating. 11 defensive rebounds, 7 offensive rebounds. And we're starting to see a little bit what we saw in the first game, the women's game. Beacons almost 1 for 1 defensive to offensive rebounds.